There's a very important question from Adri.
I know. And we're back for part three of our Stella-thon.
That's right.
We are we're past
part
6 hours.
Has started, yes.
Part three has started.
We've made it.
Darcy's turn.
Oh.
We made it to the top of the mountain, and we're now going back home. That's what we've done.
The cat is in the cables.
Oh, God.
Okay, there we go.
Amoeba jump is extra hard when cats are trying to fuck with your controller, too.
Any gameplay is extra hard when cats are trying to get involved.
No!
We have a concert tomorrow.
Yes. Oh, dude, what concert are you going to?
I don't think we can make it to the thing. It is a punk concert.
Punk and Drublick.
What's your
No effect. No! Bad Religion.
Wow. Yeah. What venue are you doing?
No. Peony?
Peony's great.
Yeah,
just
a Peony.
It's also
Is it the outside
craft,
stadium?
It's also
or like
a
the
craft
one?
Brew.
Yeah, that's a great place for a concert.
Yes, craft
brew. It's a craft brew festival and punk concert.
Oh my God.
And you Punks guys, and Drublick.
You'll just get to drink beer, sit outside,
listen to punk music. Bonus credit.
Oh.
For not being able to see.
Darcy, I'm sorry. Darcy, come here.
No, I died. It's someone else's turn.
No, keep going.
You need a good shot.
Oh, watch out. Stop. Watch out. There you go.
It actually is much easier when you're facing the screen head on, too.
Definitely. It's like, yeah, you're right, because
it's a warped perspective
the
from the
totally
side.
Blocked.
Yes, yeah. NoFX. Favorite band. Seen them a few times. Mick Muse. Which favorite band? NoFX or Bad Religion? Who else is on the bill?
That's crazy.
A lot of good bands.
Let me look it up. Punk in Drublick.
I'm very excited. It's going
to
be fun.
Yes. We went to a punk
festival in Las Vegas.
Yep. And had a lot of really good punk bands.
Yes. It was a great festival. I would go back just for it.
Yeah.
Okay. 3 days. It was a 3-day festival.
It's NoFX, Bad Religion, The Real Mackenzies, Anti-Flag, Chicks Dig It, and The Last Gang. And 50 local craft breweries, which is the big draw, I think.
Yeah,
my really good friend Wolfgang, his dad owns Brass Neck, so he does bottling there, and goes to all the festivals. So I guarantee you, he's probably gonna be at the festival, slinging some Brass Neck
Wolfgang?
Beer.
We'll look out for Brass Neck.
Yeah. If you see Brass Neck and a guy named Wolfgang. His hair will be standing up.
Does he look like a Wolfgang?
He does look like a Wolfgang. he's his parents are from Austria.
Okay. Nice.
Yeah, hence the name.
That's right. And he's got a very white voice. He speaks very deep all the time.
All right.
Even though he's like this skinny little guy, he's hilarious.
Nice.
Oh, so Mick Muse saw Bad Religion in Montreal. Very nice. Yeah, NoFX and Bad Religion are both incredible bands. I actually interviewed NoFX.
Really?
Once, yeah. But they were, not really NoFX, but I interviewed Fat Mike as part of Me First and the Gimme Gimmies. Because they're playing in Vancouver, and I was doing some punk-related things.
Yeah.
You played music back in the day. Hey, did you?
I'm a singer.
Punk? What kind of music did you play, dude?
It was electronic music.
That makes complete sense.
kind of synth poppy.
Oh yeah, yep. That makes
industrial,
sense. Well.
Industrial,
yeah,
industrial. Oh
yeah, barely industrial. It wasn't that hard. Some of it was a little bit harder.
Yeah.
But yeah, between like the range between synth pop and industrial, in that range, yeah. Technically, the band's still going.
Really?
It never broke up.
Never broke up. And there's a third album waiting for my vocals to be laid on it.
You gotta do it, man.
Yeah, I gotta do a lot of things. I have so many projects that I need to
get
done.
Your voice is probably like lowered quite a bit as well. It's probably quite different. Because it just happens
over
time.
Over
time,
yeah.
I shouldn't say necessarily lowered. It's probably just changed a lot, though.
Changed. A little bit. I listened to shows that I did because I've been doing this type of thing for a very long time.
Yeah, I listened to
this guy.
I listened to some rant media stuff, man.
Yeah.
And I was like, you sounded definitely very different.
Yeah.
Not in a bad way, just as in like you could just sound like your voice was a bit higher and like, but that's just how it goes.
I should find some adapters. It's not gonna help.
I have a real soft spot in my heart for that peony like location.
Is it?
See it.
Well, you can't see it because I'm in the way, is the problem.
So you're fine now. Okay. We're the same people, but yeah. Our voices probably changed a little bit.
Yeah, just the textural quality. That's the thing.
Yeah.
And that's just what happens, you know, your vocal cords. I also think
we could test this theory very easily.
By listening
because
to
we
recordings.
Have so much video, so much footage of
pull
it.
Pull something up. We got to pull something
I don't
up
think,
by the end
I
of
certainly
night.
Don't think that my voice has improved. It sounds exactly as terrible as it always has.
People in the chat, you got to vote for Beyondside Ireland to play a little bit of them.
No, we don't need to
they're
going to
resist, but if we unanimously unite...
They can look it up themselves.
Yeah, it's
still
all
out there. So.
Yeah, it's all online.
It's in the
I remastered it and put it on YouTube. Hundreds
well,
of episodes.
You had the vision to record VHS and all that stuff, which is crazy that happened.
By accident and on purpose.
Yeah.
Because we were doing, Darcy and I were doing radio shows.
Yeah.
Starting back in 1999, streaming. Streaming like we're doing now. And we had webcam too. So
it's
we
20
were,
years.
We were,
it wasn't a That's webcam, crazy. It was a video camera.
Well, no, it was a video camera. That fed to a computer
yeah.
that updated pictures,
but it was
a JPEG every
like
once in a while with an auto refresh.
A VHS-C video camera, or the equivalent. Like, it was like a...
yes.
Or, yeah, I think
no,
that
no,
one
I
was.
Never had a VHS-C.
No, it wasn't C.
Yeah, I never had a VHS-C.
What was, it was mine. It was an 8mm.
Yeah,
8mm video, yeah.
8mm analog.
Wow. Yes.
And then...
No night vision.
Damn it.
we play Medieval Mayhem 4-player.
Oh. Yeah.
After
four
this,
yeah, Arena,
sure
we
shall.
Got our back, dude.
Good suggestion, Arena Foot. Let's see if there's any more. Oh,
yeah, we'll find out about these donations.
Oh, I got the email from Splendid Nut for the palette demo.
Yeah,
to help us do.
That'll be fun. I don't quite
yeah.
know how we're gonna
Thank
do
you,
it
Splendid
yet. We'll figure it out. That's half the fun.
I know. I mean, the color representation on here I find really good.
Hell yeah!
And
well,
so I think
you,
we
I mean,
want to
look
try.
At that. Those whites are white, and
really
that's the
white.
Sign, right?
Yellows are yellow.
You just gotta find something. That's the best way to deal with it is to like find something that you know is black and white.
Yeah.
And then that'll help you find your center.
Yes. My turn.
And particularly, that's also like, but Spies in the Night is an amazing game for that because you throw that on anything,
yeah.
you know that if that should be black and white because it don't
spinning
that has
this.
No color.
Everybody
Stop spinning it. People are gripping
what
it.
Cute
hard.
Little character, this amoeba.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, he's a great
little guy.
Yeah.
What were the old iterations before the amoeba?
There's Poodle Jump.
Poodle Jump,
and
yeah.
Doodle Jump is the original name, so you had to change that.
Yeah, I played Doodle Jump on the iOS, like, way back when. When, like, Angry Birds was a big thing. That was when I was playing that.
That doesn't feel like way back to me, but I guess it is.
It is. Well, for me, I was
relative
like,
time.
For me, I was, like, 18, so.
Yeah.
I was basically not a person yet.
Oh, come on.
Oh, come on!
I mean, what do you say when you're 18 that like that's really meaningful? Like that's the tough thing about being 18. There's nothing you're gonna say or think that really is worth writing down.
Not a whole lot.
No. But it's
you're just out of high school. You haven't experienced much of the world.
No.
Nothing meaningful enough for me to remember having said it.
Totally. Yeah, I think about that sometimes. I'm like, what did I talk about
joystick.
In middle school?
Oh,
like, I can't remember
joystick.
A single conversation I had. Like, what did we do all the time?
This is a hard jump for the beginning of the game.
Yeah.
Oh, you brought the fan. It is cooling down now.
So much better. Tanya, thank you.
Yes, thank
You're
you.
The champion.
That's a genius move.
A genius. Which buttons are the best? Red?
Green goes higher.
Oh, okay.
So really, one green if you want to bypass mm-hmm. stuff.
There is no
well,
best.
You get points
how
for
you
going
it.
Up, right?
Yeah, you get points for going up, you get points for collecting the letters.
And the letters continue when you're up higher, so.
Yeah, they always continue. I mean, there's spots where it's just blue and just white and there's nothing else. But,
like every game that I do in the 2600, my method is just don't die.
Just
like
avoid
dying. If I just don't die in a 2600 game, I'm generally doing okay.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good strategy.
Whenever I get fancy and I'm like, I'm going to collect the things to, like, I always die. And I'm like, well, who cared
Stuck
if
your
I'm
neck
collecting
out too
the
far.
Things?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. If you can't continue the game, then...
I Just kind of let it happen organically, you know? Like, oh, if I happen to get all these numbers, awesome. If I don't, whatever.
Do you get points for catching it if you already have it?
Yeah, you still get the basic points, whatever the points are. So it's good to get them if they're easy enough to get. I need a no, though.
There's one.
That's not a no. That was an M.
The most hilarious version of this one, you could just do springs on every jump.
I see that you were correct.
That was like the craziest yeah, version.
That'd spring be so version.
There's the O.
Yay. Ding, ding, ding.
James, so now what?
The dream is alive.
Now you get a spring right there.
Yeah. And then
rocket into space.
Rainbow.
You get the big points,
rainbow
and then you just do it all over again.
Wow, you're kicking ass.
Hell yeah, man.
No.
What did you get to? You got to 8,000?
I was at, yeah. I died at like 7,900
I do not like these. Continually,
but,
yeah.
But I blamed the controller for my death.
That was my fault, not the controller. Yeah. There's no letters right
all.
Away, so it's best just to go for springs.
Yeah, people are saying it's yellow on their end.
We know it's yellow, but it's better than the alternatives.
What color should
they
be?
We're currently hanging out in Mexico, right?
Everything should be north. Should be yellow.
It is yellow.
I think that's the hackiest color thing of all time.
I mean,
where it's like when you're
it
in
needs
Mexico,
to be a bit more saturated, but it's a pretty good representation.
Yeah, it's pretty close. It's like the colors aren't exactly the same, but they are.
Those platforms are yellow.
Pretty
from a
close.
Certain.
They are yellow, yeah.
There's the right-ish colors.
Oh, they do see the letters. Oh, the letters are slightly yellowed.
Oh, they're kind of too
Oh, what do we say about the... Oh, muffin.
Yeah, you're going to have to put up with it. We'll do some color calibration next time, and I'm going to write it all down so that if it ever goes off, then I can reset it.
It's going to be brilliant.
It's going to be amazing.
It'll change all of our lives.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. That was not good.
So addictive.
The color used to be really, really bad. Whoa.
And doing terrible just
whoa. Because I had the button.
Yeah,
set to revenge.
That was terrible. Start over.
Yeah, and I love even when you're playing with a group too. Sometimes you just like die and you don't even like ask anyone. You're like,
no,
I'm doing it
no,
again.
No, I'm just.
No,
no.
I deserve another time.
No.
That was not worthy of a game.
That's my standard rule.
Oh, I got it. Nice. What's your standard rule?
Oh, that I deserve another turn.
Always.
Because I suck, and if I feel like it's my turn for a turn,
right,
then I shall get one.
Rainbow
that was
hidden. Powers!
That one was hard to get at.
Yeah.
If you miss it, you miss it, right?
Oh, yeah.
Boom.
No, another one comes back.
Oh.
Oh, I see. This is terrifying.
You get your super rocket.
Did you play the game QB?
I think, yeah.
That one which had like the patterns, and there was like one, and you had to like, they had like a little like.
And
oh, I did
on the
terrible
right.
at that. Yeah, James was doing really well.
You might like it.
Would
I enjoyed it,
me.
But it's the kind of game that
I
feel
don't
really,
think I ever sit in one spot, anyways.
Well, then they'd be fine. The
I
want to
play
ones,
it by
all
myself
blue
first,
at,
so that I get the strategy.
Or something?
I feel very
hard.
Nervous when
yes.
I know people are watching me do it and figure it out for the first time.
So
I don't feel like I did very well, but it was really fun.
Yeah, Matt, like,
QB?
There's a bit of stress when the developer of the game
I know,
watching
is watching
you play.
You play it, and
oh,
I'm like,
definitely.
Oh my gosh.
Somehow I managed to not, like, remember those things when they're happening, which is really weird.
Yeah.
Like, I sort of, like, get in a weird zone. But, like, if I do think about stuff like that, it's done. Like, there's no
it's
way.
All over.
Yeah.
There's no way we're going to be doing anything.
Yeah, you can jump on the edge and
yeah,
completely miss.
Pretty funny.
It is.
It's awesome.
It
is
awesome
is.
That it's that accurate.
Yeah.
That the whole
I'm always excited when the picture, when it's not just like a hit zone.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
real. Like, that platform is the platform.
Yeah.
That's the one thing about 2600 games is that collisions are based on pixels.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Unless you don't do that, but mostly it is.
Yeah, Rena, you feel our pain. He just said, I was that way when I played Stay Frosty 2 for the first time
oh,
with Darrow watching.
Stay Frosty 2 is so hard.
It's hard.
Blue level! Good work, James.
Thank you. Oh my god, that was hard.
Oh.
Yeah.
I hate the blue level.
Do you think this amoeba will ever get home?
No.
No.
It's tough life.
The blue level's temporary?
Yep. Just like the white one.
So
and you go back to this,
like
and I think
patch.
There's another white one, and then another blue one.
Yeah, patch.
Is there a white blue one?
That would be terrible. That was good. That was a good run.
No one near 21, but
you died.
Pretty
Who
good.
Who wants to go now?
Airline. I can do it, yeah. Let me take a seat. Let me try it.
We have to be careful. We'll get in trouble.
We've been smacking into this mic so much, James. I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, that didn't cover the mic.
Okay, good. What I just did was what I wasn't supposed to do. I'm sorry.
Yes, but Darcy has fixed it.
Oh.
Okay. So we're coming up to Nathan's... Yeah, wonderful.
How's it working?
Nathan Strum is going to be joining us.
Nathan!
On the chat.
Nice.
At 7 p.m.
Holy shit. What games has he done? I should know this.
He is the graphics and artist extraordinaire. Yeah.
Amazing.
He does the graphics and artwork for so many games that I don't even have the full list. Did it for Aardvark, Draconian, Mappy, Toy Shop Trouble, Galaga, and endless
Holy
others.
Shit, man.
Endless. So many.
Is there a way...
Yes.
And I believe I know the answer is negative to both these questions. Is yeah. there a way for the Atari to write a bit to a card or to the...
Oh, you mean go back?
Can it send information out?
Yeah. Yep. It... Or can it?
Ooh.
Back to... Yeah, because there's RAM. Is there? You know, there... That was a question. That was something that was talked about recently. Because people were wondering, oh, can I just save a game on the cartridge? Technically, you can use the Atari Box.
Atari Box.
Because that has read-write capabilities. And people do... I think there's some games that have save games in the Atari Box. Don't remember, though. They have high scores, but save games? I don't think there's been a save game down there, even though it's completely possible.
Okay, so there is a way to do it using the Atari Box. Okay,
using the Atari Box. So you can do RPGs and continue on and stuff like that, because somebody is making a game called Penultimate. Which is
that looks cool.
Which is pretty much Ultima. And he has used an Ultima as the template. Ultima 3 as the overland.
Like green rainbow jump.
Yay. Or yellow for them.
And it's definitely
it looks green on the other computer.
Good.
Okay, so the other question
is in out through joystick ports, not cartridge connector. There we go. That's what I thought.
So you could save a bit then through Atari Box.
And load it. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So
That's yes.
So that's yes.
With
that's
that equipment.
Exciting.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
And it's fairly cheap equipment.
Yeah. The other one is sound. It's mono.
Yes and no. There have been modified games to output stereo, but
through
I don't...
the joystick?
No. Right on the... But I think all it does is put channel 1 in the left and channel 2 in the right. It's not like stereo, but it is stereo. So if you say, my game is in stereo, switch to stereo mode, you'll get stereo.
Jesus Christ.
Then yes.
I'm like,
and so you say channel 1 and channel 2, how limiting is that?
So
each one can make a different type of sound.
Okay.
8505!
Oh,
and can they each make the same a sound at the same time?
Yes, they can. So you can go up and down volume, so it
should
can be a panning kind of thing.
Okay.
Yep. Cool. It would have to be the same sound, though. Or even different sounds could be like... So you could do like the sound of the ocean, like a white noise type of sound.
But I mean, like, if you're trying for stereo, you want the same sound.
Yeah.
And you just want different volumes.
Yeah, that's right.
Otherwise, it's not stereo, it's...
Spiceware says the 2600 was designed for two speakers to be inside the Atari. So if you look at the grill on the Atari, there's two fake holes in it. Well, not fake holes, they're real holes. And that's
speakers,
where speakers were going to be.
Yeah.
Whether it's going to be stereo or just happens to be two speakers in mono, probably most likely mono, but maybe they had higher hopes. But I mean, it was always probably supposed to look like it fit in with your stereo equipment. Because of the nice wood grain. Console is stereo, but mixed to mono for output? Really?
Interesting.
So, technically, combat is in stereo.
Wow. Look at this situation.
Well, there you go, Darcy. The Atari 2600
we're doing it.
Is actually stereo.
Wow, I thought both of those questions were no.
That is just bad luck.
And they were both yes.
It's like
they were both yes. It was, but they're both
they're
like,
both qualified, I think I had to just push
yes. They were like yes,
or maybe go
but.
The opposite.
Yeah, yes, was
right?
It qualified?
I think that was the shortest
yeah.
way.
No, think, yeah,
yeah.
Right.
That's interesting. Those are good questions. Many early games were designed for left or right sound. Oh, okay. Because that's true, because you could play one sound and have it be somewhere, and then, you know, like, say in combat, you're two tanks firing at each other. One guy fires, play that firing sound, the other guy fires, then switch to that one moving. But you still only be able to do one sound at a time if you're going to do a stereo sound, because you have to play two mono sounds.
Yeah, but again, like, it's that's not a huge limitation when you're... Because stereo is...
For special instances, right?
Like, if you're trying to give spatial information, then that's going to be the same sound in two ears anyways.
Yeah. So that... Some people have rewired up their Ataris to be back to stereo again and separate the two mono sounds.
So the trick is that, yes... You can do stereo, but no, people can't get it. I guess if they played it in Stella, they might be able to.
Yes, that's true. Yep. I bet there's a switch in Stella.
Stella. God.
That allows you to do it in stereo. Combat doesn't switch, but right player always comes out of right channel, left always comes out of left. Okay.
Predicament. Okay.
Medieval Mayhem utilizes stereo. As the dragon flies across the screen, he flaps sound and also moves back and forth. There you go. Spiceware made a stereo game.
But if nobody can hear it...
Does it make a sound?
No, but you can get it. Can you get it then in Stella?
Just got philosophical.
Yeah, I've got the right people. There is, since Beyond the Scenes, that's how hardware works. Emulation in Stella. Yes, there you go.
Right.
So, Medieval Mayhem on Stella, on your computer, as the dragon flies back and forth, is in stereo.
Nice.
So it's a resounding yes.
Awesome.
For both those questions.
That's great news. Man, I've been grinding this one. I have not been able to find the one that I need. Mm. So
you just bypassed it. It was
I've made it to, like...
Another A.
Yeah, good luck.
You have to loop around to the right.
I know. I gotta move.
But I don't think any game has utilized the save and load off of AtariVox yet. I think it's mostly been used for just high scores. Just saving. And then, of course, when you load the game again, it loads the high score list.
Well, I was thinking, like... saving, like... Okay. So you could combine games.
Right.
So you have a game that does this, and then it loads a different game.
Cool time to get a spring.
For a mini game, and it knows which one to load because you have a save point outside of the game.
Yes.
And so you could move between, like, completely different 4K games.
Yes. Exactly.
I don't know if you could. There could be other limitations, but that's what I was thinking.
Like, take Ultima, for example, on the Commodore 64.
Yeah.
That had multiple discs.
Yeah, yeah.
So instead of multiple discs, there's multiple cartridges. Or
yeah.
Part two. You
yeah.
know, you won part one.
Yeah, like,
here's
oh,
your
you've,
equipment, here's
you've
your stats.
This level, put in the other cartridge, and now you're on the next level. And so you could have
yep.
a larger game that relied
that
on save points off of
Fuck.
The thing.
You could even prevent the person from playing part two if that save key was not the right
yeah yeah
like a yes a
yeah.
yes switch
yeah
of course people would be or maybe part two you just start over again if you haven't actually made it to that point because it be fairly limiting, because if you sell 100 cartridges of part one, you know you're not going to sell more than 100 of part two, because nobody can play part two without finishing part one.
Yeah, I mean, I envision it as being, you know, like one game, not a whole bunch of separate games. And it's the sort of thing where, at least, like, it's not the sort of game that would lend itself to being on cartridges, is really ultimately it. Like,
right. Games can get really big on the Atari. Like, I think 512 is the biggest game. 512K. And if you look at Penultimate, you'd be like, oh, okay. Yes, an RPG, big RPG can be made on this system. For sure.
Cool thing about RPGs is you just need design. Like, the thing is you don't actually need a lot of stuff to be really happy with them.
Yeah. You have all the basic elements, and once you've got those graphic elements, then you build things out of them. 3,000.
Yeah, that was going to happen. I saw it about two.
Dude, I had 9,500.
You did?
900.
Yeah.
Oh, missed that.
9,900.
But then I literally jumped, and then the platform that I was going for disappeared.
I saw that spring, and I thought, don't go for the spring. It was, but you didn't hear me.
But
why
it was,
can't you read my mind?
Especially when I was, because I was so close to 10K. Man.
Yeah, really
I really wanted to break 10K.
Ispo says, that's why there's so many bank switching methods. It's getting a read to become a write. Wrap your mind around that. Steven says, yep, that missing write read line really causes a lot of problems. One of the major deficiencies of the 2600. So, the Atari has the chip in it. It's a 6502. Mm-hmm. But it's a kind of an altered 6502 chip, and they called it a 6507, and it had a number of lines that were cut, and that's one of the lines that they didn't include is the read-write line, if I'm not mistaken, to save money, because they didn't have to do as much work.
I mean,
yeah. Are you done?
I want to keep going, cause I'm like, but I don't want to ruin the stream by me like amoeba jumping forever.
Yeah, so you have today's highest score, right? 9909.
Yeah.
Well, the thing that's frustrating is, like, I keep dying in ways that are not, feel like it's not my fault. Mm. In the last, like, the last three times I've died have been, like, you know, like, I spring all the way to the top, and then it's, like, there's nothing nearby. Or, like, I am going for something, and the thing disappears. Like, if I die legit, there's a feeling of, like, okay, that was my fault. But when it feels like it's, like, you know, but that's also, it's all my fault. I need to make judgments.
That's true.
I'm not really sure what that's like, to feel like that, like it's not your fault.
Well, you know, when you make a call and it's like, and then the platform disappears, it is your fault, but it's like that thing where you're like, you just miscalculated it, and then it's like, well, it's not, but
it's
kind of
your fault, but kind of
But at a certain point, I come back to just, you have to just try not to die. Whenever I get fancy is when I die. I've noticed this.
Oh, the read-write is missing from the cartridge port. It's present on the 6507. Oh, okay. So they could have wired it up, like one extra wire, and that all would have been solved.
This is my last game, though. You have to cut me off.
Yeah, I will.
Because I will want to continue.
Yeah, we'll cut
Amoeba
you off.
Amoeba Jump is
addictive.
Mm-hmm. I find it to be the most addictive homebrew game.
It's
Wall Jump Ninja comes a close second.
Well, that's what we're playing next.
Oh, excellent.
I've never played that before.
Oh, it's so much fun. Okay. I haven't played it in a while, so I'll probably be terrible, but it's so much fun. It's really addictive. Really addictive. We played it once. We played it for, like, off stream. We played it for
it's
hours.
It's the opposite of Amoeba Jump, because...
yes, it is.
Instead of using only the joystick, you use only the mouse button.
Really?
Yes. Yeah, and you're jumping.
Button. It's so simple to play. In so many
ways. That's the
simple
thing about,
and hard.
And hard, yeah.
I like it a lot.
Good design is elegant, you know?
Yes, and this is one of these games that's so elegant. It's just left and right.
That's it.
But there's so much to it.
Yeah.
And same with Wall Jump Ninja. It's so precise and elegant, but it's so simple of an input.
That's it.
Rip. You're cut off.
Please, you have to cut me off. You can come.
That's okay.
Okay, press the button.
You can come.
Pushed.
There
back up. But I did get almost 10K. So that's
yeah, good. You're very close.
Doing a shuffle over. It's just good.
Oh, you're back. You're in a subdirectory that you don't need to be in.
Nope. Wait, how do I go back?
Up to the top. There you go. Go to today's date.
Go to delete.
Delete? Oh.
That's just testing.
Are you sure? Yes.
Testing stuff. Doesn't actually delete anything.
There we go.
I haven't played Wall Jump Ninja in a long time.
You had a world record for a while, dude.
They don't have the same date.
Yeah, the same.
I don't know if they have the same date or not.
It's just repeated three times.
What was it?
There were three versions.
Hmm.
Yeah, I Lather swear the picture's getting foggier.
Oh, we need to fix something, actually.
Foggier.
Oh, yeah?
I think it is getting foggier.
It's the heat.
Maybe it is getting foggier.
It also
maybe
the
filter should be taken off. It's like
no,
heating up on the inside.
I'm curious if it's a flare now.
Oh, a little bit is.
Is it flaring?
Yeah, it's like a bit.
Oh.
Where's the flare coming from? Oh, because it's a wide angle?
It'd be from that.
Yeah, it is. It is flaring.
Do you wanna
I could see.
I can fix this so that it won't flare.
Yeah, because I can see.
Welcome back, Scum Software.
Yeah.
That's
not a good
call. Let me look at this. Oh, no. I think you picked the PAL. So pick the top. Wait, don't do anything yet.
Hands off the controller!
I'm going to look up. Yeah, it's too long. Too long of a name.
Probably the first but you one. Can tell which order it is by looking at the names, if you can see all three.
Yes. The funny thing about this cartridge system is that the order on the cartridge is the order you put them on the cartridge, rather than alphabetical order, which is a little weird.
So
can we play?
Which
we
is the most recent one you put on there?
But it would be taking it off of here, which is in alphabetical order, so it's probably the first one.
It might also have something to do with us having been, like, recording for, like, 7 hours straight, too. Mm-hmm. That might also be part of the...
I hope not.
I hope not either, but... I mean, I haven't...
We're in this camera for...
For 7 hours straight.
Yeah, it's the first one.
First
NTSC.
One?
Yeah. That's why the other... What did you pick?
I don't
know,
the third one.
Colors.
I think she picked
third
the last
one.
Yeah. PAL 60.
And we want Lab and Heart.
Yeah, we need to fix this.
Why did it work, then?
Lava.
Hard.
Not hard. No,
no,
not hard. No. This is the one that I compete on.
I'm just looking to see if you have a lens hood.
Oh, that?
Probably not.
Why, this
no.
Is so
but if you had one that was
I do
like,
have a lens hood, and it should be in there.
Because, like, that'll be the way to do it.
Ooh. It's on the side, the one that,
this side?
That's open already, that's unclipped. That one. Open that one.
Oh, no. No!
No!
Oh, maybe not then.
That's okay. It's worth a go.
Hold the button to scroll the file name. Oh, thank you. I was supposed to. Oh my god, I didn't even know that.
And what did we learn today?
We learned how to see the long file names.
Oh, no.
You really see the noise in this game.
Yeah,
this
you
is very,
can.
Very solid colors.
Noise.
Yeah, you can see the crawly, creepy crawlies on the blue area. It's kind of like going like this.
Oh, I see.
Slightly moving. It's like it looks like compression. Someone
yeah.
didn't read the manual. No, I didn't.
Why? What did you do? What would the manual tell you?
It would say hold the button to see the full file name scroll.
Oh, I see. Yeah. I thought you were talking about the color.
Oh no no.
That's like I. Surprised that there are
no.
such settings.
What's the room that you made it to, James?
67. And the world record now is 69 that beat me.
Whoa.
I used to hold
really?
The world record. Yeah.
Whoa.
So that is what we're going to try and do today. We don't have a lot of time.
No?
Well, actually, after this, I don't know if there's anything other games.
Know.
We're going to play four-player... Medieval Mayhem.
No, and
Bart.
We do have Astronomer, so we're pretty good.
52 is pretty good.
We're going to be speaking with Nathan Strum
Someone
in a few
it.
Minutes.
It's all in the timing. There's no... Yeah, it's just one button push.
Is it lens flare?
See that? You see that so much better.
Okay, take it away. Oh, yes, it is. Which is it from? It's not from those. It's from that one.
Really?
You can turn that off. No? Let's see how it looks. Oh, it's fine.
It barely
That's
changes.
That's better, actually, without yeah. it.
With there
it.
We go. You bumped the camera, too.
Oh, I did?
Oh, no, no.
I don't think I did. Did I?
No.
No, no, it's
no,
good.
No, it's fine.
I can move it over.
No.
Oh, that's cooler too, actually.
Yeah. So I'm gonna set up Nathan Strum, so we'll be talking with them with him soon.
Uh oh. No death.
Oh, should I try?
Yeah. You should try.
I've never tried this one before.
Just press the button.
Holy shit.
And the longer you hold it, the longer you jump, the further you jump. It's important. Sometimes you need to tap and sometimes you need to.
I feel like a ninja. Until I land in the lava.
Hey, Pixel.
Hi, kitty kitty. I'm gonna go.
Put my Atari socks on. My cat Atari socks.
Dude, you're
socks
on brand. It's good.
Me too.
Yeah, just different Ataris.
This is Kaboom socks I've got on. Activision socks.
Ah.
Oh, what do you do in situations like that? Just try not to, like, go through too many at once?
It's good, but you want to make sure you're high enough.
Like, you landed in the lava, and that doesn't normally
You
happen.
Want those letters.
Yeah. Okay.
Because you want to spell out ninja.
And then you
which
zoom
gives you
forward.
A super
Although,
zoom.
To be yeah. fair...
It's like jumping up floors.
It's like your usual rule of don't try to get too clever.
Good.
Yes. Yeah, if you're going to die getting it, don't get it. And you missed it. Well, that one's hard. I always miss that one.
Uh-oh.
So the auctions are doing really well.
Yeah, if you go off the screen,
should
100%.
Do another, or does someone else
want to?
Okay.
No, you do it again.
Okay. It
if you go off the screen, but like a pixel of your foot is still on the screen, you're okay. But if they all go off, then you slide straight down.
See, like that.
That was close.
Like, I don't. How does one dodge that? Just.
Two things. One, you just don't do it. Two.
Just
you
don't do it.
Rarely. Even come close to hitting the lava, like it's.
Oh, the lava is not a concern.
Well,
he died once jumping into it.
Oh. It was just because I jumped through like two, right?
You have to keep high enough a little bit.
You just get used to knowing.
You kind of want
to
be as high as you
like
can,
that, right?
No,
to get
you
through
fine.
What you need, yeah.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Oh.
Oh!
Oh!
Oh! So
the dream was alive.
Yeah.
Button one hand, drinking the other.
That's right.
I'm
yeah.
waiting until 8, and then I'm going to start drinking.
Oh, see, I started right after. I've had a rough week, in my defense.
I know,
it's been a very rough week.
I get it. There's nothing wrong with it. I just know me that I'll just be tired and not good.
Yeah, I'll probably fall asleep in about an hour.
Oh, no.
And just be my Skittles, I'll be okay.
So we're going to be talking with Nathan Strum in about 2 minutes. He is graphics guy extraordinaire. My notes say he has endless number of graphics and artwork for games such as Aardvark, Draconian, Mappy, Toy Shot Trouble, and Galaga, and many, 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 many more. He donated the Retron 77 console, not this one, not as pictured, that is in the eBay auctions right now, and it is up to... Where is it? $355.
Wow.
Which is incredible. I think that is the top one with Galaga close behind with 315.
Holy cow.
So it is quite a bundle. You get the Retron 77 complete with a whole bunch of homebrew binaries, some of which have never been released to the public. A stack of manuals donated by Al from Atari Age. And a whole bunch of accessories that allows you to hook up a USB joystick to the console, a Genesis controller joystick, and a couple stickers and buttons, I think, as well. So it's a really good prize pack. And the community has, as we've been talking about it, made the Retron 77 a very good machine for emulating Atari games. And you can plug in old Atari games into it on cartridge and plug normal Atari-style joysticks as well. So we are going to switch over to that. You can continue playing.
Good. Doing half decent. Good. Except there.
43, 44. It's good stuff.
Yay.
Oh, that was skimming.
I remember when that used to be the death of James.
Oh, that one?
Yeah. That is hard, those things going up and down. So you have to hold and jump at the right moment, but don't hold too long because you're going in the lava.
Keep pushing. You have to not jump right away.
You just have to know the timing. Yeah.
That's the thing. That's basically all you have to do for that is to not jump right away. But most of the time, jumping right away is desirable.
What a nightmare this ninja's living in. He's just
it's a nightmare.
Never ending like lava just kicking off walls.
I imagine that he's one of those cocky fellows that doesn't even consider his own mortality, and when he finally gets electrocuted against the electric wall, he doesn't even notice because he's looking the other way. And it's just like he's just dead, doesn't even just
I love the like whole narrative sleep, you're giving this guy's life. I think he's just a stick figure.
Also it's a lady.
It's a lady. That's a twist.
Okay, we're gonna phone.
Hello. Hi.
Hi. Good. You can hear us.
Yeah. Can you hear me all right?
I'm going to adjust the volumes here. Sorry, headphone users. You're now deaf. So hopefully that's not too bad.
It's loud, but it's not ear splitting.
It was really cranked up. Okay, so you can hear us, we can hear you. That's excellent.
Oh no.
Actually we can keep it on this screen. So welcome Nathan. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing well. I've been watching the Stella-thon in the background all afternoon and really enjoying the different interviews. I thought that it was great to hear from Dan Kitchen especially and get one of the original programmers' perspective on coming back to the homebrew scene. That was fantastic.
Yeah, it is really interesting. Somebody who legitimately programmed while the Atari 2600 was out for Activision, and now coming back into the scene and seeing how it is now and programming new games. So he's in a very, very unique position. And I think I asked him once if he knows anybody else that has ever done that. That somebody who had programmed back in the day during the reign of the 2600 and has come back again and has made an all-new homebrew. And he mentioned somebody who finished off a game that they started back then, but not somebody who's ever come back. So I think he might be the first one, unless anybody can fact check me in the chat or if you know anyone.
The only one I'm aware of is Rob Fulop. He came back and finished off Action Knots with the help of John Payson and a few other people and put out a limited release of that, but other than that, I think the closest would be D. Scott Williamson, who did his own version of Star Castle, but he was more of a Lynx programmer than a 2600 programmer.
Okay, yeah. So finishing off a game that you started back when it was out, I don't count that. So probably Dan is the first one to do that, but there might be other ones.
This was like this the whole time.
So thank you so much for your amazing donation of the Retron 77 package. It's unbelievable. It's doing really well. It's the top one in all the auctions.
Yeah, I'm really surprised. I'm really pleased about that. I wasn't expecting it to go that high because it certainly didn't cost me that much money.
No, and I'm surprised too. Like it's a retail thing, but there's so many bonuses with it that I think people see a lot of value in that. And of course, all the games you did all the footwork for collecting all the homebrew games that are included on it and getting permission from all the developers. And I want to thank you so much.
Yeah, that was really important to me to make sure that this was done legitimately. A lot of the ROMs are already available online and you can find them in the forums and they've been freely shared, but I really kind of wanted the homebrewers stamp of approval with this because they all use Stella, they all support it, and I felt it was really important to do that. And then also Albert providing all of the printed manuals to go along with it as well. I think that really makes it a nice item for people who are into homebrews and want that little extra piece with it.
Oh yeah, yeah, very very good package. Sorry, Danny was talking to me. Yeah. Oh, what did you say?
No, I was just asking which screen was actually showing, was broadcasting.
Oh, it's this one, but now that you're not playing, it's fine.
Okay.
So you are the person who does a lot of the graphics and the box art design, and I wanted to see what kind of connections you have with Stella, and probably it's in the graphics that you do for the games. And testing them out. And you did you do the aardvark graphic, the big aardvark?
Yeah, I did all of the graphics in aardvark, and I also did the box art, which I've sent to you to preview today too. And I did that actually when I was on summer vacation on an iPad using a really simple application. Usually I use Photoshop, but I was away from my computer and found this little Commodore 64 sprite creation tool and just started poking around with it. And I just had a lot of fun with it. It really kind of forced me to rethink how I was doing graphics. And I didn't have any of my Photoshop tools or anything, and I just was poking around with this one pixel at a time. As far as how I use Stella, I use it all the time. I started using it almost 20 years ago. And just to play games mostly. And then when I started developing graphics, I'd send off the graphics to whatever programmer I was working with at the time, and they'd send me back a build. And in order to make sure the graphics worked, I had to check it on something. And I didn't have a flash cartridge at the time, so there was no way that I could see if the animation actually worked in context or not. And so Stella allows me to, you know, quickly play a build that a programmer sends me, and I can step through something if it looks wrong and take screenshots of it, take those screenshots back into Photoshop and figure out what went wrong and then fix them. And I use Stella all the time for that. I use it for tons of play testing. I tend to get, you know, these binaries that, you know, from the programmers when I'm working on these games, and they're always looking for feedback. And that's really critical for a game to really be developed to its fullest. I think that's one of the things that's so great about your show, is that you're providing that feedback that programmers are so hungry for. Thomas mentioned it earlier today when he was being interviewed, how he wishes he'd have more YouTube videos of people just playing his games. And so I've tested a lot of these games that I've worked on. It's close to 50 now in one capacity or another. And Stella is critical for that.
Yeah, and I also see a lot of developers saying in the Atari Age forums, I don't have a Harmony cart. Can somebody please test this out? It works fine in Stella. So there's a lot of developers that rely on Stella for their for making their games, because they may not have all the hardware or the money for the hardware to test it on actual equipment. So it's been quite a good boon for developing games on the 26.
Yeah, and they've done an amazing job making it even more accurate. I think Stella 5 was probably one of the bigger jumps. I think that's when they changed most of the core to be more cycle accurate. And then I don't remember if it was Stella 6 when they started changing the audio. And with every major iteration, it just keeps getting closer and closer to the hardware. And that gives the programmers more insight into if their game's going to work or not. For example, when John was playing around with doing some bus stuff in games, we had a special build of Stella that worked with bus stuffing, but we couldn't always get it to work on real hardware. Well, now those same ROMs no longer work in Stella, because Stella is now more accurate to the original hardware.
Wow, that's incredible. And Stella seems to go hand in hand with the development of games that are pushing the limits of what has been made before. And luckily, it's such an active community that Stella can be updated, like you were saying with the bus stuffing, as things progress. So that's really interesting. And it is the audio that I think that was cycle exact now with the release of 6.0.
Yeah.
So it's amazing. Yeah. I guess that goes along with the power of computational power that Stella is running on now, that you can get closer and closer to the actual emulating the perfect emulating it.
Yeah, I've been dabbling in emulation of one form or other since probably 96 or 7 with MAME, with some of the earliest builds on the Mac version. And I remember even back then, the computer that I had, there were only a handful of games that really ran well under under emulation, and then they'd start choking. And at some point, I had to get a new computer to run some of those games. And there was even times when with Stella advancing, where you'd read complaints from people who had a really old PC and Stella would no longer run full speed on it. It's like, well, come on, get rid of your Windows 3.3 machine and get something newer. But it's kind of astonishing to me how much processing power it takes to properly emulate something that was so simple back in 1977.
Oh yeah, it takes a whole lot of processing power because you're essentially translating things on the fly that were done in hardware. You're emulating hardware in software, which is unbelievable. It takes a lot of processing power just to emulate just like this old stuff. They haven't even, they're still trying to get PlayStation stuff, I think. PlayStation 1 going perfectly on modern hardware. So it takes a lot of horsepower to do it. I think that was my introduction. It was in the mid-90s with NES emulation and Atari emulation. I thought it was fascinating that I could play an Atari game on my computer, and I didn't need the actual hardware to do it. I think that was before I got another Atari. I can't remember if I had the Atari first or if I played on an emulator first. Can't remember.
Yeah, I had my Atari first, certainly. I bought mine back in 81, and it's still the same one I use now.
Yeah, and that's a testament to the how long it can stick around for. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, well, it's had some work done to it. I've had to replace capacitors, and I've had to replace a couple of chips in it, and I've put in an S-video mod, and, there's probably not a whole lot of original components left in it now, but...
So I know you do a lot of graphics, and I think you have done some of your own games as well, if I remember.
No, I haven't created any games. I'm not a programmer at all. The closest I've come to creating something was I came up with the idea for Stay Frosty and subsequently Stay Frosty 2. Daryl, gets the full credit for taking that project on and programming it, and Mike Haas and others contributed to Stay Frosty 2 as well. But it's something I don't take for granted, because that's a very rare thing. There's a lot of people who post, hey, would somebody make this game for me in the Atari Age forums? And that never happens, because every programmer has their own laundry list of games that they want to make. That's, stretching into the next 20 years. And so for Daryl to pick that up, and I think part of it, he can correct me on this, I think part of it was his nephew was over visiting, and they were talking about what sort of holiday-themed game we were going to make that year for the Atari Age cart. And I think his nephew mentioned, oh, you should make something with a snowman in it. And that happened to coincide with me posting that idea in the development forum. So it was serendipity, really.
Yeah. So is your background in art, or is it just something that you enjoy making, or do you do it as a hobby, or as your job, or an interest in 8-bit games?
It's a little bit of all of the above. I've been drawing since I was a little kid, And but it wasn't until about my second year into college that I discovered that you could actually make a living as an artist. And so then I switched majors and eventually got a degree in advertising art, which kind of encompasses everything from illustration to graphic design to typography. And I worked as a professional graphic designer for a while and wasn't really satisfied with that. And so I went back to college and got a degree in character animation at CalArts. And I never actually went into the animation industry. I ended up staying at CalArts and I taught for a while. And since then, I've managed the computer labs for the character animation program there. And I've been doing that for 25 years now.
Okay. So does anybody have questions in the chat for Nathan Strum? Is anything else that you wanted to bring up or talk about?
Well, it's just the whole Homebrew experience for me has been really kind of incredible because, again, I'm not a programmer at all. And when programmers, you know, start reaching out for help on the forums for sound or for graphics or whatever it is, they're very welcoming to anybody who wants to contribute. And I've never felt like an outsider, really, even though I don't always feel like I'm contributing very much to the end result because, you know, I don't do any of the programming. That's, in my opinion, all of the hard work. And so, you know, I'll spend, you know, a few days maybe working on the graphics or something, and then the programmer will spend the next 9 months, you know, churning through the code, trying to make everything work. But I've never had a bad experience working on any Homebrew with any programmer. They've all been fantastic. I've met very few of them. I've met Zach Matley in person and Bob Montgomery and Glenn Saunders I met. He's the one who was the filmmaker behind Stella at 20. And I've met Albert, and that's about it. But I feel like I know a lot of these people very well because I've worked with them a lot. And the thing that's really surprised me most is how international this whole thing is. Because I've worked with programmers in Italy and in Brazil and Germany and the UK and all over the United States. And Aardvark was made by Thomas, who's in Germany, and Oscar, who's in Mexico, and I'm in California. And I worked on some of the graphic design for Boulder Dash. I didn't create the label artwork, but I laid out the manual. And, you know, Andrew's in Tasmania and Thomas is in Germany. I think you can't get three more distant points on the globe.
Yeah, it's an amazing community and amazing how people can come together to make something really, really great and using all of their individual talents. Do they usually come to you for the artwork, or do you see a project and go, oh, that would be a good project to lend my talents to? Or how does it usually start?
Well, the way it started originally was I kind of stumbled across Atari Age while looking for ROMs for Stella. So that's kind of appropriate to this whole conversation. And I found out about Homebrews, and I was thinking, wait, somebody's making new games for this system? And this was probably around 2001 or two, but there was no YouTube, and there really wasn't much information about them, so the only way to find out about them was to hang out in the Atari Age developers forum. And so I saw that, I think it was Aaron Curtis who did Fall Down, was asking for help with the Running Man sprite in his game. And having the background that I did, I thought, oh, well, I can help with the animation on that a little bit. And so I did that, and he used it in the game. And so that was kind of the first time, you know, I'd gotten any credit or had any involvement with that. And then I did the same thing for Bob Montgomery's Go Fish. And then Bob asked me to work on Reindeer Rescue. And then I was asked to work on Colony 7 by Manuel. I'm not going to try to pronounce his last name because I'll mangle it, but he goes by Cybergoth. And I think that led to John asking me to work on Ladybug. And then, you know, so as I worked on more games, other programmers, because they're all a very tight-knit community, they say, oh, I kind of like what you did there, and, you know, would you be interested in working on this? And so it just, it leads from game to game to game. And if you're, you know, if you're willing to work with them and just kind of help, you know, because that's what they're really seeking, is they're, you know, they don't want somebody to come in and take over the project. They want somebody to, you know, fill in the gaps. And, you know, then I think there's no end of work, really. And as far as the, like the box art and that sort of thing, that all started because I started entering label contests on Atari Age. And I entered a couple. I entered one for Climber 5 and one for Backfire and promptly lost both. But then the Crocodile cartridge, which was, I think, Armand Vogel's flash cartridge, I won that one. And that was a really high-profile contest because all the programmers were going to get a Crocodile cart. And so I won that contest. And then because I'd entered the other ones, I caught the eye of a couple people who asked me. And then Albert started asking me to do labels. And because it's hard to find people who are willing to commit that kind of time for no money, you know, it's all a labor of love. And so
yeah, it is.
I just keep getting asked by people, and sometimes it's people I've worked with before, and sometimes somebody will just see something else that I've liked and they said, hey, can you do something like that for my game? And I'm happy to oblige.
Yeah, obviously your artwork is unbelievable, and it's in-game and on the box art as well. I mean, the programming takes a lot of time, but these enhancements of the sound, like the sound that I Supposed to does, or the artwork that you do, really brings the games to life. Did you work on Chaotic Grill a little bit? Are you doing work on that?
No, that's entirely Splendid Nuts' work, I think. I don't know if he's working with a graphic designer on that or not. I wish I could remember his actual name. This is why I do not use an online handle, because when I introduced myself, I, you know, prefer to introduce myself by my actual name.
Yeah, it gets confusing.
Yeah. No, I didn't work on that. The next games that I've got coming out that I worked on will be Wizard of War Arcade with John, Galaga, Aardvark, of course, with Thomas and Oscar. Those are, I think, the next ones that are slated for release. And then I just sent John about 50 sprites last night for a game he hasn't announced yet. So we're kind of
sprites.
Excited. Yeah.
Yeah. That's a lot of sprites for hockey. I don't know if that's hockey.
Well, I can say it's not hockey.
Okay. Can't say it's not hockey.
It's not hockey. But hockey's definitely something John and I are discussing. You know, because
how many sprites
wants
will
to work
be
on that.
For that?
For hockey?
As
many as he'll give me space for.
Yeah, I guess that is a consideration that they must give you limitations of, you know, lines and size of the sprite and how many that you can make, because how much room they have left over. Is that something that they pass on to you that you have to take into consideration?
Yeah, that's about the first thing that I ask for. Because I can't really make much of a start on it unless I have an idea of what the target is. So for Mappy, for example, John had to let me know what the heights of the characters were, and that, yeah, I could do, you know, color changes per line with them, and that they were going to be a single line resolution. And then I had to find out, okay, well, how much animation is in this game? And fortunately, somebody had done a sprite rip sheet for the arcade game. And so I could just basically do a one-to-one translation from that. But other games like Wizard of War, there is none. So I had to go and play Wizard of War Arcade on MAME, record it, and then do my own sprite rips. And more often than not, I end up having to do that sort of thing. And then it's, you know, how many frames can you give me for this animation? Sometimes I'll create a piece of animation, and as the game develops, that number of frames will go down because they have to have the space for either more levels or AtariVox support or whatever they're adding to it. So Star Castle Arcade, the castle explosion in that game is not procedural. That's all just animated. And the original animation for it was really, really smooth because I basically swiped it right off of the arcade game. But as the game developed, they had to keep chopping more and more frames out of it. And it got so bad at one point, I just cringed whenever I saw it. Then Thomas started working his magic that he does with saving ROM space and started adding frames back to it. So where it is now is a nice compromise between the two. But that happens on a lot of games where, you know, if they'll give me the space, I'll fill it with animation.
And did that happen on Aardvark, where the number of frames of animation in Aardvark is astounding on the main character? Did you have a lot of room to work with that and you just said, I'm just going to go for it? Because that seemed to be probably, next to the dragon in Medieval Mayhem, one of the most animated sprites ever created for an Atari 2600.
Well, thanks. The way that Aardvark worked was originally Oscar was trying to recreate the M Network prototype. And so if you look at his early builds and screenshots from that, it looks just like the M Network prototype, which is rather crude looking. And as he progressed with it and as Thomas got involved, they decided that they wanted to push it closer to the arcade game. So my first passes at the Aardvark looked like the Anteater from the arcade game, which looks terrible. It's this big orange blobby thing, and it has like two or three frames of animation, and that's about it. And so Oscar wanted me to improve it, and I said, well, do you want me to just improve what's there, or do you want me to create something different? And both he and Thomas said, well, just create something new. And I asked how much space that was available for it, and Thomas said, well, it's in its own bank, so just go for it. Just start animating. And so I was able to add in a lot of frames to that and do things like having its head move as you're moving the joystick back and forth, because in the arcade game, the Aardvark itself is static. You never see it move much once you're controlling it, and I thought it'd be more interesting if it looked like you were actually controlling the Aardvark instead. And so I got to do things like that and add in a few other little touches like it breathing and some things like that. So we were able to do quite a lot with the Aardvark. Oddly enough, though, the insects were in another bank, and that was full, so we couldn't really do anything else with that. And I wanted to add more insects to the game, so it's always a trade-off.
Yeah, but the Aardvark is astounding, the animation and number of frames. Yeah, especially when he's just... you know, just sitting there and you're playing the game, there's, you know, little movements in the mouth or the trunk of the Aardvark as he gets the ants up. It's really, really great work. There's a question from the chat. Did Nathan do the particle explosions in Frenzy? And that's Daryl Spice Jr.'s game.
Oh, no. That was all Dave Vasquez. Dave also did all of the artwork in Medieval Mayhem, so he did the dragon and the knight in that game as well. And he also worked on some stuff in one of the holiday carts. I think it was Grandma's Revenge on Stella's Stocking. And I think he's done some hacks as well. I haven't seen him around the forums much lately, but he's a phenomenal animator.
Definitely. I think that's about it, unless you had something else to add. I definitely want to thank you again for the amazing Retron 77 donation for the Stella-thon. It's obviously raised a ton of cash, so that's incredible. Thank you so much.
Well, you're very welcome. Doing this. It's been fun to watch. I think that the interviews have been a lot of fun to watch and finally hear what Thomas sounds like. I was expecting a little bit more of a Texas drawl from Daryl, but I'm not disappointed either, you know.
Yeah, it's been wonderful having all these people on that I haven't talked to in person, but I've chatted with, and of course you have too, over many years on the Atari Age forums, and I've seen their pictures and met some of them in person, but it was really nice to talk with them on the show finally, and yourself as well, and so thank you so much for being part of this and being part of a huge part of the community too. Thank you so much.
Well, you're very welcome. It's been my pleasure, and looking forward to the Aardvark artwork reveal later this evening sometime.
Yeah, we're going to do it right after this, I think. It's a good bookend to your call-in.
Okay, great. Well, I'll be watching most of the rest of the evening, so hang in there, everybody, and drink lots of coffee, and hope you have fun.
Well, thank you so much, and we will chat with you soon.
All right.
Okay, bye, Nathan.
Bye.
Excellent.
Oh, we got a reveal?
Yes, it's because the Aardvark and a bunch of other huge games, Wizard of War and Galaga, are coming out at the Portland Retro Gaming Expo. Like, get your wallets ready, people. bunch of games. So he just sent over to me the other day the final, might be final, it's probably final, Aardvark artwork for the box and the cartridge. So while I'm getting that ready, somebody can take another swipe at this, and then I'm going to go for my world record.
Oh, do you want to play?
I'll try one or two. And
sorry,
then
I was just sitting in front of the fan over there.
I was so envious.
I was going to say, we can switch if you want to sit in front of the fan.
Oh, it's all good. Sure.
Much cooler.
Good discussion, Nathan, Dan AVC says. Yeah, great call-ins. Thank you so much for everyone calling in. That's all the scheduled call-ins we have. Ooh.
Do we have any non-scheduled?
maybe some random non-scheduled call-ins. If Arena Foot has survived,
Brian,
how are you doing, Brian?
What's going on with your hurricane, dude?
He may not have power. He
said, he was having dinner, because of the hurricane, and we definitely. We need a hurricane.
Yeah, Barry.
Barry.
We need a hurricane update.
Yeah, we do.
Seriously,
actually, we could go check it. I can't remember what city he lives in.
What happened? I was off the screen there for a second.
Were you?
Some of those walls, they almost extend, and you can't see them.
Yes.
So you'll hit it, but some of them you'll go
can't
over.
Go except there's no rain yet.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Oh, you're okay?
Oh, that's not exciting.
That's not good for the show.
We need drama. We need tension. We need, you know, is he okay?
We need humanity.
Denham Springs, Louisiana.
We're so happy to hear that it's actually going to be okay. Hopefully it's just a minor thing, and you and your family will just hang out at home. And...
Oh, you hit the top. Not too high. There you go.
Yeah.
Okay, let me get that artwork ready.
I was watching the, what do you call it? See, this is...
The thing.
Yeah. thing. I was watching the demo.
Of... 45. That's good.
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
I was watching the demo of this going back and forth, and I was kind of thinking about it as it was going, because I was like,
I was watching the demo, and every time it reached room 18, and it just kept bouncing back and forth, and you know it's coming, and it's like, no, slide down a little further.
But that's the thing that was the most useful, was to see just like how where you're positioned on the second wall is everything.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
And I was like, oh, I just was able to wrap my brain around it a little bit better.
Okay, we're going to do... Actually, I'll wait till you're dead.
Sure.
You will die.
Oh, everybody, I definitely will.
The world record is 69 rooms. You will die.
Oh.
It's one of those games that's... It's probably one of the shortest games that you can play.
This is definitely like the brother or sister to Amoeba Jump.
Oh,
like,
it is.
Hell yeah. Like, it's totally. it's in the same family.
It
used to be a two package deal.
Because it is the same. It has the same meditative zone.
Yeah. I bet Amoeba
and
Jump's
you can't
coming
stop
out
once
too.
You start playing this game.
Amoeba Jump might be coming out too at Portland Retro Gaming.
Oh,
Expo.
Really?
So it's going to be a
that's
good...
worth getting in.
Oh, yeah.
I know what booth I'm going to be at the whole time I'm there.
Yep. So it'll be a good stack of new games.
I'd like to go to Portland, man. That seems like a cool city.
It's very cool.
It seems like a kind of place I'd just get along in, you know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, for sure.
Like, see, things like that jump, I was just thinking about like those kinds of jumps based off of like how he was doing.
I have done very intricate calculations. Oh no.
See, I flew too close to the sun. Room 45.
Stop. Okay.
Stop. Stop.
Okay, we're going to reveal the artwork.
Look at this.
For Aardvark and Stella's Nathanstrom.
Cool. Nathanstrom's name at the top, which is cool.
Is that up?
No. Okay.
We're reacting. Ooh, it's so great. Been able to see it.
Okay, so here is the box art and the cartridge artwork. So there is the side of the box. Very cool colors.
It is, yeah.
Mm. And here's the... if I can get it working.
Nice.
Whoa. The front of the box. Nice. Very, very nice.
Beautiful work,
very clean,
man.
Right? Yeah. Just got the Atari Age, Aardvark. There's the other side, pretty much just like the first. There's the back of the box. Aardvark, a game for the Atari VCS 2600. Welcome to nature. Guide Oscar the Aardvark in his quest for tasty ant eggs and the most delicious ants hidden deep below ground. Mm-hmm. But be careful with your tongue. You could get an unexpected bite. Can you clear out the entire anthill before the sun sets? Be wary of overstaying your welcome, or the spiders will get you.
Ooh.
By Oscar Toledo G., Thomas Jentsch, and Nathan Strum.
Sorry, Thomas...
Jentsch.
Darcy's coming back.
Yeah,
man.
He phoned in earlier, and I said, please, pronounce your name for me.
Jentsch.
And Nathan Strum, copyright 2019, Oscar Toledo G., published by Atari Age. And there is the cartridge itself. Very nice colors.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Very, very cool. Love it.
So thank you, Nathan Strum, for sending that in. Oh, sweet box. Nice. Spiceware says.
Really
Dan
nice.
K says nice.
Yeah,
yeah,
I'm going to
really,
use the
really
bathroom.
Me too.
Oh.
But
One at a time.
Let me get a practice run.
The master takes control.
Because I'm not going to get my top score yet.
We'll see.
It's okay. Tilted like this?
We had to keep the wires safer. At the arc, the top arc of your jump, there's an 18 or 19 pixel clearance. And when you get up to the high levels...
It disappears.
Your guy exactly fits through that opening.
Mm-hmm.
It gets so small...
It's so hard.
...that you have 19 horizontal pixels to get him through. You have no vertical pixels. You only have horizontal pixels.
Yeah, so you have to be...
It's
unbearable. Absolutely
perfect. You have to plan your top of the arc... for when he goes through it.
Mm.
So a good way to practice is to just clear it. Like, practice just clearing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the longer you press the button, the more he jumps, the higher he jumps.
Yeah.
And the other thing that is going to help you is timing when you get the letters.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Because for me to get the world record, I have to hold off getting these letters, actually, to the very last moment, because then you will reduce the number of...
The number of harder levels.
Yeah. So essentially...
You need to, like, hold off until you pass by the doable ones, so you can skip more of the impossible ones.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe if
so
I'm...
So you can push yourself forward.
Yeah.
If I'm correct, the warp is 10 levels long.
Mm.
So the world record's 69, so you want to get to 59.
You need to get to 60.
Yeah, 60. That's right, I need to beat it. I don't want to tie the world record. I want to beat the world record.
But you might be able to get Ninja twice, too.
Not in that time.
No?
No. If you get Ninja
twice,
you
were... If
you
did, that would blow away the score.
Blow away the score. That is the next thing you'd have to go for, actually, is collect every single letter.
Yeah.
And then do it again. But I'm going to do the other thing first.
I think if you've memorized the levels, you can figure out the patterns you need to catch the letters in the first jump a lot of the time, too, like if you've been practicing.
Yeah.
Because a lot of these letters, if you time the fall, you can get them in the on the jump over, rather than having to do it on the jump back. Not all of them, but some of them. So I think the more memorized and timed you have it, also the further you can go. But... There you go.
Now I just need one more, but not yet.
I actually made it to 53 the first game I played.
Oh, jeez.
Which, I'm surprised.
So I think I need to skip a letter now. Yeah, I don't want that yet. But I want the next one?
Maybe.
Oh, God.
Well,
yeah.
No, because you're at 52 and you want... We want to get to 60.
Yeah, so but the letters aren't on every
world record 69.
And right, that's why you need to get to 60 because it skips 10.
Yeah.
But so there may not be a letter at 60. There may not be a letter at 60 as well, right?
They seem to be more frequent than once every 8, though. And he was at 52 when
you
skipped. Do you
want to take note of where they are?
Which rooms? We did this before, I could swear.
That was terrible.
Notice his practice run was done two runs ago.
Well,
that's how this game. That's how this game rolls. You know, it's.
The bathroom is not available. But yeah, ooh. We will need to chart this out.
Room 11.
11 for the first letter.
Yeah.
You can just write down numbers.
Yeah.
Because if you don't get the N, the next one's an N too.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it.
It always is an order. It's not like amoeba jump.
No, it is not.
Room 19. Yep.
And this will help.
It's actually every 9.
Is it?
So far. No, that was 8. And then. Yeah, it's 8.
35?
Yeah, it's every 8. So actually, you were 35? Correct.
Did you get 35?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're correct that you would have wanted to take the next one. 43.
43.
Yeah, so you actually can't. You have to successfully navigate one level after this, unless you want to get all the way up to.
When is it predicted for the next one?
I predict the next one will be 59, which means that you would have to get
one more
to finish it there,
and then get one more,
and then finish one room, or go 8 more rooms and then finish it.
Oh God. I think I want to do 8 more rooms.
You think? That's pretty tough.
Well,
maybe we'll try it that way
first.
You
just do it and see. And if you don't, then we just use a little more electricity and try again. Mm-hmm. Nobody dies. Nobody has to die.
Correct.
Well, someone could die.
Except for this little
ninja. That makes
ninja.
For an exciting stream.
Except for this poor little ninja.
Oh, yeah. He dies over and over.
How many do you skip when you get the thing?
I think 10. I may be wrong.
Dude. I can't remember now.
I think it's around 10 at least.
It's 12.
It's definitely at least 10.
Think so?
In fact, 67.
Five.
So
could be 5.
You have been, unless you got it, if you got it at 59, you would have exceeded the score. So you must have gotten the last one at 52, which would have gotten you to 62, and then you did 5 more levels.
Not a chance I did that. I don't think I did that.
No, you skipped and then did levels after.
A couple levels.
Yeah.
So I think it's more than 10 then.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, I think it must be.
Don't want that.
But what that means is that if you
cap it off at 59.
Damn it.
Then you will have immediately...
One?
Yeah, so you should take the one at 59, and then we will see whether or not it's 10 or what.
Okay. I think that's the best strategy.
Of course, you need to get to 59, and so far, that has not happened.
53, close, 53 is challenging.
You got close to 59. I think you got 57.
Yeah, room 53, up. that yeah, plumb bob.
Oh, the plumb bob.
Yeah. gets in the way.
The old Darcy plumb bob. Yeah.
Good old plumb bob. What's the chat say? I didn't look at it.
Thanks for the kind words, and thanks to Oscar and Thomas for asking me to work on it and letting it be previewed today.
Yes, thank you.
And people
are
saying sweet artwork, which is, you know,
accurate.
Very accurate.
Yeah. And Scum, you stuck around.
Wow. Long term.
I think I came back.
Yeah.
Well, 12 hours is a while.
Yeah. Coming back is almost more impressive.
It depends what time zone you're in, too. Like, yeah.
That's true. Some time zones are brutal. We're in the best time zone for our stream.
Yeah.
Imagine that.
So who would be watching it at midnight? Like, time zone-wise. Other than this time zone.
Oh,
the Pacific
Europe.
Time zone. Europe would they be awake in the morning? Ooh.
Europe in the morning.
Nicely done, sir.
Because there is a possibility that we're going to talk to Thomas Jentsch.
You need this one.
Oh, I do?
I think so.
Oh, yeah, I do. That's right.
Ooh. 52. Plumb Bob. Watch out for the Plumb Bob.
Yeah, he's mean.
God, that Plumb Bob.
Uh-oh.
Whoa.
54.
These aren't the hard ones, though.
Oh, no, they're pretty hard.
No,
the
they're huge.
The timing is pretty crazy. No, this is where it gets really
this
hard.
This is where
it... Ooh. Ooh.
Nicely done, sir.
Oh, 57.
The plum sticks.
When is it predicted?
59.
Damn it. One more, then I'll go to the bathroom. Then I'll come
See,
back.
See, this game gets you.
Yeah, this is war.
That's right.
Yeah. Before you know it.
Pack Rat is going to make it all the way, he says.
we believe in you.
Yeah.
What time zone do you live in, Pack Rat? Are you in the West Coast? Makes it easy. Even East Coast, you can do a 3 a.m. on a Friday.
CST, so that's Central, right? Is that?
Yeah, that's two from us, so that's 2 a.m. when it finishes.
That's not too bad.
It's Pacific.
There was a time when that was my normal bedtime.
Hmm?
2 a.m.?
You know what? Bedtime?
Yeah, for years we went between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m.
What were you doing at that time?
Just not watching TV, just not going to bed, and then like getting up at like, it's not like we didn't sleep, it's just that we didn't have to be up before a certain time.
Yeah,
and so it was
well, you just get in a rhythm, right? And that's how it goes.
And then we switched to the amber light, the blue light filter, and the night we switched it, we went to bed suddenly at 11.
Whoa. What's this filter? Like, tell me about this filter.
Well, you know how, you know, the it's like screens have all of the colors of light, and
yes.
Blue light tricks your brain into thinking that it's daytime.
Yeah.
And when filtered out, like, your screen kind of looked amber.
Red, almost.
Yeah, it gets this hue. But it does have an effect, which is that it doesn't keep you up. It doesn't put you to sleep, it just doesn't keep you up, right? Like, the difference is...
Yeah.
It's not that blue light is bad. It's that it makes you think it's daytime. And so, you know, it's sort of like if you are trying to sleep in the extreme north during the summertime and there's
damn
a nice sun.
Yeah.
You know, it can have an effect. That's all.
I'll be back.
Who wants to play?
I'm very close
to. Aaron, do you want another go? Or?
Sure.
It's up to you.
Let's do it.
I'll slide over here.
Just
slide down.
Yeah, you get over here.
Okay, cool.
I'm
certainly not going to.
I think I told you that, because you can get it for your devices as well, to stop you from staying awake.
Nobody knows. That's okay, you can go again.
Fire.
You're like bouncing.
That's funny.
I was like, whoa, I got no power.
That's the next challenge.
And
that's like level 20.
That's
just
like
play it on
after,
Megafire.
After you're good with the cats like jumping on you, then you Megafire yes. it and you're
yeah.
good.
No, I had a like an e-reader, and then all of a sudden I didn't. I was using my tablet, and all of a sudden it was like 2 a.m. and I had to get up for work the next day. And I realized that the light on the screen was keeping me up. I wasn't feeling sleepy, so I was reading for like 2 straight hours. It's quite shocking how much it affects you.
Oh, it's insane.
It's like really, it's really strong. And then I got the filter that he's talking about, which makes it look red, but...
Yeah.
But at least you can
but
sleep.
But then I fell asleep, then I would get sleepy. Like,
it
I just wasn't getting
James
sleepy at all.
Nuts, but he most hates it. People just... Unless it affects... Like, if you're looking at text, it can actually interfere with your ability to see, to read the text. But unless it's something like that, you usually...
Well, I mean, the idea is that
you're trying to go to bed,
your eyes
right? Yeah.
You're not,
balance,
you're
right?
not actually...
Yeah, it's not during the day. You wouldn't have it
no,
on
you
during
do it at
the
night.
Day. Yeah.
At school, people... Is it Flux or something?
Yes,
is Flux is one.
The
yeah.
iOS one?
That's
right?
the one that came out before the... no, it's not iOS. It's actually...
Is it Apple?
PC.
Really?
Really?
Yeah.
I thought Flux was Apple.
No, it's
I had
Apple.
Plumsticks.
Apple eventually put it built in, as did Android. Like, they're just built in now. In fact, I
oh,
think
really?
Even I think
I
Windows
app,
has
but...
it built in maybe now, too. I'm not
okay.
sure.
Makes sense.
It actually is
workshop. It's just that it turned out that, you know, a lot of things sound like woo. And it sounds like the sort of thing that might be woo. But I'm telling you, I read about it, and I was like, oh, I'm going to give this thing a try. And that night, we instead of, like, our crazy slipping towards 3 a.m. Bedtime, we were, like, tired and decided to go to bed at 11.
Yeah.
We're like, wow, like, is this a placebo? And I was like, I don't think placebo works with falling asleep.
It really
does. We truly underestimate how much we are mammals. And we are, like, products of our environment, you know? And how much light affects us, how much, like, sleep affects us, food affects us, community, culture. Like, it's crazy.
I believed it. It's just that, you know, like, placebo's a real thing.
Oh, yeah.
And it has a real effect. And so sometimes when you try a thing and it works, it didn't. And I was just... Even though I was the one saying, let's try this thing, I was still skeptical, you know?
I don't know if you'd like... doing it, Erlyn.
It would drive me crazy.
Me
it drives
at
him
it,
crazy.
It drives me nuts.
Oh, I think
at this orange screen.
Well, my jaw.
I think Erlyn could do it more than you can.
I don't think
he
so.
He has a different personality type.
I mean, he's a colorist.
That's
yeah, but
it's his whole world is color and accuracy.
Yeah, but
and you
does,
look at
he's
the
not,
screen and it's.
I don't
looks
think
like
he's
broken.
I don't think he's automatically enraged. I think he can go. Oh, that's right. The reason this is like this is because of this app that I'm using.
Yeah.
Whereas you just go, the world is wrong. Destroy!
That's accurate.
That is a good point.
Just looking at this pattern, and there's no way that I would make it to the next 5.
It's so hard, yeah.
But you could get to 59.
Oh, 52.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
But that's what I'm saying is that I think 59. I don't see how you would get it.
You beat me.
To 65.
Nice.
Yeah.
Or
67. Oh,
I think
good
you couldn't
job.
Get to 67 because that's what you got to before
that
using
hard.
It. But
yes.
I think 59, if you get there, you are guaranteed.
Very, very
not
good.
Not terrible. You got to slide in there. And
yeah.
I'm getting a beer, man. It's
actually,
time.
Yeah.
Actually, you're not guaranteed. It is possible that
does
it only gives you 5 one? Levels or something.
I'm sure.
It could be that
you
got to 59 before.
It's more than 5, I think. But maybe not. Maybe
I'm
not.
Just saying, I'm just saying the math is, it's conceivable. That you got to 59 before and that it only gave you 5 levels or whatever.
Oh, Steven's been with us from the beginning. Wow.
It's midnight there. Been watching since the beginning. He's getting tired now, yeah.
Yeah. He's on the...
8, yeah.
East Coast.
Yes. 4 hours.
4.5.
Oh, wow.
He's in Newfoundland?
Somewhere around there, I believe.
I think it's just Newfoundland that has a half an hour.
Yeah.
Just Newfoundland. Sticking out of Canada.
No, not out.
Part
at
of
the
Canada.
Edge of.
At the edge of Canada.
Oh, yeah.
So close to Europe.
Oh, God.
Yes, Newfoundland, he says.
Uh-huh.
It's just a number. The time.
I mean,
that's right. It's all, it's abstract. It's not relevant.
It's totally relevant. Yeah, we do a 24-hour game night at the store where we play board games for 24 hours. It's really, for normal people, more like a 36-hour marathon.
Because they're up before.
Because you don't get up, because we start at 6 p.m., and people don't get up at 6 p.m.
No.
So it's not right. That it's a 36, but it's 24 plus. It's like 30 to 36, depending on when you get up.
Yeah, maybe you try to nap at noon, but is that really going to like help? I mean, it would help, but that's not a real sleep.
It'll help you a bit.
Like, I think 7 a.m. to 7 a.m. would probably be easier.
Yes. It would be easier to complete. It would be far easier to complete. But it would screw up your day way more.
Yeah?
Yeah, because then it's like you wake up. Well, you would be able to sleep.
Yeah, but
then you'd wake up and then your whole week would be screwed up.
Yeah, you'd be a nocturnal animal.
It's like you have to stay up later to complete the 6 to 6. 6 p.m. to 6 p.m. But afterwards, you go home, you go to bed pretty early, and the next day you wake up a little late, and you've mostly caught up.
That's a good point, man. Yeah. I did a 24-hour movie marathon at the Cinematheque at one point, and that was terrifically fun. That was one of my favorite times.
Whoa.
And the midnight movie was great. They played like some horror film, which was this like ridiculous like Italian horror movie, and like.
That room.
Dude, it's the same one I died on.
57 is hard.
57 is a wall.
It's a small thing. There's two spikes.
Yeah, you just have to.
I don't know.
Some of your marathon days, though, are basically 12 hours for sure. For like the movie marathon?
Either you caught the 52, the bus at 52. And it was more than 10, or you did get the 59, and it's less than 10.
Yeah, that may be it.
Yeah.
Which is horrific. I remember ending mine on not a warp, but at least two levels that don't involve a warp.
Yeah.
And they were tiny, tiny, tiny little openings. And I almost
and 59 is bigger than that opening. It's just a tricky launch point.
The one 50, where, 57,
sorry, 57.
Yeah.
57.
Yeah, it's just a tricky launch point.
It's brutal launch point. Brutal.
But the hole isn't the tiny thing. No. So therefore,
not yet.
It is better to go to 59, no matter what.
No matter what. Yeah. Yes.
You know what's very terrific about this game is the work they've done in the physics of the spring and how your arc.
So good.
Very organic. I mean, I mean that's about the only thing that the game kind of really needs.
Yes.
But it's
everything
very
else is
well
window dressing.
Yeah, it's very well done because I do feel like I'm actually aiming.
Nice.
Wow, you evaded two things just barely. Yeah, that's the whole game. Once you've nailed that, you're good. Like the colors, the changing colors, that thing chasing you, like it's all essential. The gathering of the letters.
Yeah, what really opened it up to me was realizing that your position on the back wall is everything.
It is.
And then obviously how much power you get.
Ah, Plumb Bob,
it's great. It's very well-maneuvered game.
Yeah, and to position yourself on the back wall, you sometimes have to position yourself on the front wall.
Correct.
And slide down at the right time and wait, especially the plumb bobs. Well, that is the whole waiting thing. Those make you really think about where you are. The lava's not... You can turn off the lava, but it's really not a thing.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to, because then you would lose all bragging points, and then never is a problem.
That's very true.
Yeah, you do slide through. If you don't have lava, you come back out the top again. So it is a different game. Somebody say something funny in the chat?
So,
are you supposed to?
McMuse is in Nova Scotia as well.
Oh, okay.
So not far off.
That's a
Newfoundland.
That's half hour off Newfoundland.
Stefana says
Steven
A666. Okay, yeah. Has been up since 6 a.m. their time, so since 1:30 our time.
Oof. Whoa,
is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're 4.5 off us.
Yeah.
That is very, very early.
relative. Have you asked anybody in charge there why there's a half an hour time change?
Yeah, why? Because
I'm sure that you know that that doesn't make any sense. Or that just make that it an is hour, an error.
Make it an hour or join the 4-hour club, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really weird. And for years we've had to sit through CBC saying, or 4:30 in Newfoundland.
Yeah, but that's not a hardship.
Hold
it's
on,
a hardship.
Are we joking or is this a real thing?
This is a real thing.
The hearing, the CBC thing is not a hardship. The hardship is living in Newfoundland and being off by 30 minutes
Someone's
instead of an hour.
Someone's got to figure that out, seriously.
I would take a 30-minute change if it meant not changing to daylight savings time.
No, but that's not it.
Come on.
Yeah, 65. See, it's only,
there
it's
we
only,
go. That
six,
makes sense.
It's only six levels.
Fuck.
No, I'm going to go for the next one.
Yeah.
Try.
I would
I think you should try.
What
I think
room
that's,
was that on?
I think that's win.
What room was that on? The
that
letter?
Was
59, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was 59.
And it made it go 65.
But I didn't look and see.
So it went 6.
It went 6.
Yeah.
Where's ZeroPage located? Generally, it's in Vancouver.
Yeah, we're
specifically.
Yeah. Specifically. We're all Vancouver people.
Vancouver, British Columbia,
yeah,
Canada.
Vancouver, British Columbia, yeah.
Best known now for the Olympics that we're here. And expensive housing.
Yes.
And being a place that a lot of places shoot but never get credited as.
Yes, for films.
We've been the backdrop of many movies. We've been Seattle, we've been New York, we've been Chicago.
Everything.
Rarely Vancouver, though, sadly.
Yeah. 50-50, was that? No, that was Seattle. That was
no,
that's
was
right,
Seattle.
But it was shot
it's
here.
Pathetic that
and
it was
Seattle.
And it was,
like, he was
that's
running around
seawall.
Stanley Park. Like,
yeah, you're
it was
like, what
just,
is this?
Like, Seth Rogen.
I'm going to avoid those, because I don't want to accidentally get them.
Yeah.
Because I have to
just make sure
bypass
you get
a lot of them.
Yeah, Seth Rogen and Ryan Reynolds are our famous
yes.
Vancouverites.
Yes.
They like to shoot here.
Yeah.
Deadpool.
Oh, pack rat meant where are we, but he said generally meaning he's not asking for our address.
Oh, well, yeah.
That's
well,
all.
That's fair enough.
He's just clarifying.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Our address. Because
you are
is...
mocking the use of generally.
Oh. No, because...
You may not have realized it, but you were mocking it.
I was, because some people go, oh, you don't know the town I'm in, it's a small town, but it's like, no, we're in Vancouver.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Not a small town near Vancouver.
Yeah.
And we're actually in Vancouver. There's a lot of, like, satellite
Vancouver
cities
proper.
That are technically...
Like, when I lived in Langley, there was one time I was in Orlando and I just said, I am from Vancouver.
So much easier.
I was not from Vancouver at the time. I was from Langley. But I was
that
like,
made you a
nobody's
liar.
Gonna... No, it made me not a douchebag.
Yeah, totally.
I'm from Langley. I insist on explaining that to you.
Langley? Where's that?
It's like Vancouver, east of Vancouver, an hour.
Langley's a bigger place in the U.S.
Virginia?
Yeah.
There's probably
yeah,
more
I don't know.
Than
Langley's pretty big now. But,
yeah, like, but it's not yeah. big. It's not big from the perspective of the world, only from the perspective of what it used to be.
Yeah, and we've heard of Langley, Virginia, so definitely it's bigger than Langley here. I'm sure nobody out there has heard of Langley, BC. It
Unless
is
they're
known
from,
for nothing.
I'm from Alberta, and I didn't hear about it.
No, it's nothing. It's a nothing town.
But did you hear about Canmore?
Oh, yeah.
Canmore.
There's Canmore. What's the other one with a C near Calgary that's not Calgary? Is it like Cochrane? Is that a place near Calgary?
Yeah, I think so.
Because I went to a paintball tournament in either Canmore or Cochrane, and I can't remember which one it was. And we drove all night, Friday night, to get there in my old Loomis van, and I was rolling around in the back praying not to die as my friend drove much crazier than I believe I had been driving.
Because it was your turn to sleep?
It was my turn to sleep, but it didn't work out that well for me.
Can anybody tell our accents that we're Canadian? Does it come through? Somebody said A, McNeese.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what prompted me.
He's Canadian.
Oh.
He's in Nova Scotia.
Oh, okay.
Ah, yeah.
No. No, Stephen A's in Nova Scotia. Oh, yes, that's
I
right.
I think part of being in Vancouver is we're very close to the kind of line, the border of the States, so yeah. I feel like our accents are more
West Coast,
more American. Yeah. But the central Canada and like eastern Canada for sure have an accent.
Yeah.
But also Canada is big, like the States, in that there's lots of accents.
Yeah. Yeah, lots of regions, and your identity is sort of caught up in where you are.
Yeah.
When I went to Ireland to visit a friend, and the cab driver said that lots of Newfoundlanders go to Ireland for this marathon or something,
yeah.
and that they sounded like Irishmen as far as he could tell.
Oh, well,
well, a lot of Irish Canadians are living in Newfoundland.
Yeah,
there's a lot of people that's where they started.
Like I have a lot of, like, I was born in New Brunswick. I didn't live there for more than a year, and that year is one of the ones that counts the least as as living goes.
Yes.
And my relatives there sound, while still sounding Canadian, sound like they speak like they're Irish in many, many ways. Although if you're Irish, I bet you would say, "Fuck you."
Yeah.
No, you don't.
Stephen says, strange thing about the A, nobody in Newfoundland says it. It seems to be in Ontario and Westwood.
I find that's more central. Like Ontario, even, and more so than the West Coast.
I catch myself saying it from time to time, but it's very specific.
It also used to be said more.
It's more like a question, right? Like A, like, is in like.
When it became a big deal with Bob and Doug McKenzie,
people
said
about
it less.
Because you don't want to be.
Yeah. But Bob and Doug McKenzie, I mean, I don't know who they're emulating specifically, but to me, they're emulating like a lower class Ontario,
that's
working
true.
Class
yes.
accent,
yes.
which is, I growing up in Ontario, I'm more used to hearing people speak that way.
Yeah, yeah.
James always makes fun of how I say Toronto.
No.
Ottawa, Toronto.
That's just how people in Toronto say
it's
Toronto.
But people in Vancouver.
You don't pronounce consonants.
People in Vancouver say
Vancouver.
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 Bang with a G.
With a G, and
Vancouver.
That ain't right.
Yeah. And
so get off your high horse, Vancouver.
And there definitely is, you know, I don't think we're as nuanced class wise as like the UK by any means.
Oh,
no.
But there certainly is a distinction between lower and upper class speech. Like there is just in accents. Like you hear sometimes people and you go, oh, that's way more lower class.
Yeah, it's just
subtle,
it's
though.
Lazier and slangier. It's just
maybe,
not
yeah.
as pronounced. Just not as clean, maybe. Oh, this game.
But we're lucky because Vancouver is quite a nice city and really like to live here. You do
beautiful.
To have some form of, you know,
wealth.
It's not, yeah, you don't really, poor people don't really kind of stick around. No. Even people who are very well off. I mean, I feel like the story of Vancouver is there's a lot of people who are like 18, 19 who move here, study something for a year or two, stick around for a year and leave. And it's like kind of it's like a rotating lobby. And if you're here past like 3-4 years, you're kind of going to be here for
a long time.
Yeah, but if you're here only for a year, and I find that too with people, especially if you're an artist. I mean, like, if I ask you how long have you been in Vancouver, and they say, oh, like a year, I won't assume that they'll necessarily stay. Not in like a mean way, but it's not, it's a tricky thing. Yeah, this is the hardest room.
Oh, good job. You're in the purple now.
Damn it!
Yeah, see.
It's death.
And you get no
death.
Chance
death.
To do it too.
Yeah.
Death.
I was just talking to someone at work today about that, and she's one of our more recently hired staff, and
I've definitely heard Chesterfield.
My rough week at work is related to the fact that we're moving to a completely different location, and a lot of people live in the city and love living in the city, but they're all considering, okay, you know, maybe we'll move somewhere closer to transit. And she's looking at that. She cannot find anywhere to rent that's even remotely reasonable compared to the place she's in.
Yeah.
And I find a lot of people at my job, they're younger, they get a position, and they're immediately looking for a transfer somewhere else because they can't afford to stay. And it's kind of sad because it's like all the young talent, all the young people you want to kind of have around and mentor and foster, they can't stay.
No, it's
they can't afford to stay, and they're quite honestly, you know, I can't speak to my what I do, but they make a half decent salary, so it's
Yeah. So if they're struggling, that says a lot.
It says a lot, yeah. So it's just kind of sad. I think it's sad.
So you only have to skip, I guess.
When is the next one predicted after that?
Okay, you can only skip two. You have to skip three. In fact, you can only skip three.
Oh, okay.
Right? Because, there's only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The eighth one is the one that you are now have just now decided to aim for.
Right.
And so you can only skip three.
Okay, so I should be getting more than I am?
Not necessarily. The maybe the last one you should pick up, because it was pretty unavoidable to hit that one, you know?
That A.
That last one.
That so I hit accidentally. Yeah,
yeah, you almost want that one to be a J.
Yeah. So I will hold
off.
It's
tricky, though.
It is tricky, because if you miss it, you don't have as much opportunity to pick it up either.
Yeah,
you're right that you should assume you're going to pick it up.
Because that one's almost unavoidable. Like, you kind of have to... It's harder to try to miss it than to get it, and that's a real...
However, right now, you've only picked up two.
Have I?
You're below half, and there's five there for you. Unless the graphic is terrible.
So I should get this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm at 50.
Yeah, there we go.
And wait for that unavoidable
one.
Don't get the next one.
Definitely get the next one. You need two. And you're at 55. They only come every eight rounds.
I know that one.
That one's tough. Yeah.
There you go.
Fuck now. Yeah, James. I believe in James.
Oh, no.
The timing.
The plum bob.
That plum, man. Every time. The pressure is on.
So I did better. Yeah. 61. What room is it going to be in?
63. What room, Darcy?
63, you predict?
No, but you were in 63.
So 59 plus 8. So 67.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Okay. So you have to get to your high score, right?
Right. Okay.
And then...
Then get the last letter.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
But if you wanted to beat it... the reason you're doing it this way is to see whether that's better.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is it harder to do those eight, or is it harder to do two
tack on
after
two.
The five?
That's
and
true.
And I think we may have just answered our own question, because... Eight
is hard. They're all hard.
It means you have to do those same ones.
Yes.
It means that you blow the score away, but you still have to do all those same ones.
I'd rather blow the score away.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's what I would end up doing anyway, I think.
When you when you get all the letters, you
warp six screens.
Is it six? Yeah,
six screens.
Yeah. Which means that. You will have to do the same two that you had to do to match your last score, plus the six ahead of it.
I never thought a jumping stick man would be so addictive.
It's so good. It's so good.
Hey, howdy. Does anyone know, what is it, Quest for Dinner?
Quest for Dinner.
No, Quiz.
Quizzo.
For Dinner.
What Quest for Dinner?
Clearly, I'm thinking.
Ooh. Video games on the something. Brain. Yeah, I've done that before. It's a nice little bonus.
Yeah.
Oh.
I kind of know the
timing.
You
know that
now.
Timing, yeah. I always get stuck there. You have to be high up and jump from high up without a lot of press, right?
Oh! That was...
Oh.
You did it, so I don't know why
alive.
We're awing, but...
Oh.
Yeah!
Oh, that looks tough.
Yeah.
Oh!
Yeah!
Holy shit, though.
Oh!
It's possible.
That was good, man.
What we learned is it's possible.
Yes.
I think that's the best method.
Do it again.
That is the one that's the height of me.
Yeah.
Yes.
But you have to do that anyways.
Yeah, I know.
Because you get to that room.
Yes.
That's it. You get to 65.
Yes.
So if you can get to 65 the hard way, then you are definitely better off holding off. because you still have to do those two hard rooms anyways.
No, but that's then right. either but then, way, it is. But then if he it gets is. It, then he then, he's,
then you then he gets six more.
Yeah, then yeah. he destroys, then destroys the record.
Destroy the record,
which is the way to do it. I think.
Destroy yeah. the record.
Scum Software says, "Oh, so close!"
This is true, man.
It was really close.
Quest for dinner.
Quizzo for dinner.
Quizzo for dinner.
Who made? I've, who
clearly,
make it?
I've clearly played too many RPGs in my life. Clearly,
because that was the question by Quazo for dinner.
Oh, Quazo.
Oh, I stopped at the name. I'm sorry, Quazo.
I have the I have the box up there.
Okay,
if you want to look. I almost ordered a T-shirt of this guy, but I didn't. Because it's a full print T-shirt, it's quite outrageous.
The side of the box does not match Wallaber. The cover of the box.
Wallaber, something Wallaber.
Wallaber?
Wallaber, Wallaber 2015.
Wallaber.
That is the answer, Wallaber.
Just Wallaber.
First name Wallaber, last name 2015. I'm afraid to open it.
Don't open it.
See, I'm afraid. For good reason.
Yes.
Because I could be murdered for having opened it.
And don't play that cartridge if you have a Atari Vox.
Really?
Yeah. There's an error that overwrites, I believe.
Your Atari Vox?
It doesn't overwrite the Atari Vox. It overwrites a score from another game.
Oh.
So it's a programming error that
and
he
nothing
correct,
can do about it.
That he corrected on a binary that is released. That's what I'm playing on. So I only play the binary. So you do that. I know that one every time now.
Yay! Hooray!
It's about these little victories. And this one you have to wait a bit.
Whoa. Did you hear he pronounced your name right? He's like, bye, Tanya.
Who said that?
Oh.
I didn't say that.
It was the last guy. No, I think it was Dan Kitchen.
Dan Kitchen, yeah.
Dan Kitchen.
He did pronounce
it.
My name, yeah.
He's like, by Tanya. I was like, damn.
I find where people are from affects.
Queso.
Queso.
Queso. What did we say? Queso?
I said quest.
Quest.
It wasn't even
I
close.
Queso.
Quest for dinner.
Queso.
Queso.
Queso for dinner.
Which he says is a cheesy something.
Yeah, it's a
cheesy
Mexican
peppers.
Cheesy dip.
Oh.
That's good stuff. Yes, he did pronounce it correctly.
I was so blown. No. I was impressed. I was like, yeah. Was he the dude?
But you
guys
can't pronounce it wrong, right?
York.
Because we pronounce it wrong.
Well,
yes,
I pronounce it wrong, so there you go.
there's essentially,
I think
there's two ways
though.
To say it. And
yeah, you told Dan the story? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
like, we heard your mom saying it, we're like, why does Tanya's mom say her name wrong?
That's weird.
Confront her about it. Hey.
Stop saying Tanya's name wrong.
No, my mom got mad at James for pronouncing it
that's
wrong.
That's hilarious.
And I...
Regardless of the fact that I pronounce it wrong, so that's okay.
I let her mom know that Tanya told me how to say her name. So, it's Tanya's fault, not my fault.
Yeah.
My name is, like, Gaelic. And as I said, I met someone from Scotland yesterday, and the way she said my name was like, I was like, whoa, that's how you have to say. I wish every, because my name with a Scottish accent is like, it's like, it just, it
flows,
because it was
probably,
meant to be,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
She was like, Arlen, or something.
Arlen.
She was like, Arlen.
It sounds like Ireland.
Yes, Arlen. So and I was nice. Like, oh, wow, that's never been, my name's never sounded so cool. But then again, a lot of things sound cool with an English or Scottish accent, so.
Yeah. That's true.
Well, the newspaper.
My British mother calls it it's Tanya.
Oh, yeah.
It's definitely. Tanya Claudine. So it's you have to have the awe in there.
Tanya.
And I honest,
oh,
honest,
no!
Honest to God, I don't know when I started pronouncing it Tanya.
Yeah.
Because it was Tanya.
When you moved to BC.
I think when I moved to BC.
And you
because
just gave
I found
up when...
I found people here pronounced it Tanya.
Yeah.
Whereas out east in different places, they would just say Tanya, and I probably just got sick of correcting people. That
yeah.
I just went with the flow of
yeah.
it. So I don't
just,
even remember. I don't
see,
even
there's
remember
no
the
W
transfer.
In your name, so it doesn't seem like it should be
Tanya.
Tanya.
But I mean how there's but Bath is very typical. It's Bath. Bath.
Bath.
It's a very like English way of pronouncing things, but not everything is aw. But
no.
Aw is definitely a way of like distinguishing, and that's more upper class.
Yes.
But like that's accent.
Tanya. That's accent. And that's accent, the thing. So my mother would never pronounce it Tanya. Like that.
That would be. That it wouldn't be come like, out of her mouth. Twist her tongue. Like,
yeah, it's always going to be Tanya. And, right. and I don't know. I've never cared. I've never cared how people pronounce my name. So it's never bothered me. I know Tanyas who are Tanya.
Yeah, that's just who they are.
Yeah.
And Taras, Harding, right? And Taras, and people who are
Tanya Harding.
Is it Tanya? Tanya?
But she has an O in her name. So she's Tanya. Tanya. Oh, Tanya. She has an O. Yeah, Tony. She's Tonya. Tanya.
Yeah.
So, I've never cared.
Did you guys see that movie?
Yeah. That was so very good. Really good movie. It was so
really good movie.
One of the best movies I've seen in, like, even the last 5 years. Like, I was
It's really, up there. It's really good.
On all levels. The structure of the performances. It was funny. It was sad. It was insightful.
Yeah.
That chick from the West Wing, Allison...
Oh, what's her name? Jenny. Allison Jenny. Jenny.
She's so such good. A good actress.
She won Best Supporting for it.
She did.
Yeah.
Somehow I liked her. Do you know what I mean? And yeah. I don't know how. That's an Olympic feat. To play that character, and in the end, you sort of like still like her.
Yeah.
But I think I admired her in a way, and had empathy for her. You know, which is that's a great performance.
Which may not exist in real life, but are able to pull it off so that she's not a terrible person in the movie.
Well,
so
she is a terrible person.
She is. But somehow you like her.
I did it for you to make you a good skater. It's like.
But she's compelling.
Yeah.
Oh,
like
yeah.
Like you get her background and where she's coming from and what she wants for her daughter. So I think that's why she's a compelling, and she's you like her in a way. Like
I think we admire people who know who they are and are not ashamed of just saying it. Yeah. And even if they're pieces of shit, it's like if they own it and they're like, I know and I don't care. Like
yeah.
we're very attracted to that, you know?
Yeah.
Which is you know
I don't want that yet.
And then what's the main actress in that one? Margot Robbie.
Yes.
Yeah. So good. She's a great actress, and it's so cool that she got to do something that was really like a proper role, you know?
Yeah. Instead of like a Batman character.
Yeah. Or like
I never saw that movie, so.
Or like the Wolf of Wall Street kind of like, you know.
Yeah, that was.
Certain vibe. Which is she's great in, but it's like a certain kind of part. It's like.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh!
All right. That's the thing about this is you can never get ahead of the electric field. But
no.
you can get back up to fully ahead
of
it. Oh, no. Pain is coming.
I believe in you, James. It's okay.
Yeah.
Oh, that is brutal.
This is no.
That's
death.
Brutal.
Electrocution.
Brutal.
Oh, 6-7. So the prediction
is
correct.
Seven.
So if you can get to 67,
that,
you're the king.
Yeah, we already knew. That's exactly what we thought it was.
Yeah, you can do that.
That's
doable.
The goal, is to get to 67.
51.
I think there's one in between,
59,
though.
59. Yeah, 59.
Oh, okay.
And 67, yeah.
The cartographer.
I'll try a couple more times, then we'll move on to Medieval Mayhem,
which
is four players.
That's cool.
Which I can't remember who suggested that, but
someone
suggested
in the chat.
That.
Yeah.
To break out the paddles.
Paddles.
Somebody will get some twitchy paddles, some people won't.
It'll just be purely by chance.
Oh, yeah. Totally chance. Who's getting twitchy paddles? So you don't want to get
it's
them
so,
too early.
It's so relaxing. There's something stressful and relaxing about this game at the same time.
Now that James is playing it and I have my beer,
yeah.
I couldn't be happier.
Like,
I'm
it's
just
all
like,
good in the world.
Yeah,
I'm just like, I could just watch James play this all day. I'm not even kidding.
And don't you find the color scheme soothing, too?
Oh, the color scheme is wonderful, yeah.
I'm not stressed.
I haven't had any beer, and I think it's wonderful.
I'm messing up because I'm getting that A too early, and it's so hard to avoid. So how did he get to 59 or 69?
I bet you he skipped it and made it through two. That's my bet.
Yeah.
It's my bet, too.
And I think that this approach is going to...
Well, it's the only way I can do it, I think.
Oh, yeah, he skipped it and then jumped four.
Yeah.
Or three, or whatever it is. Because you get to 65, right?
Are you sure you haven't...
That's my bet.
Yeah.
I hate those plumb bobs.
We're on the frontier, friends. We're hacking through the weeds.
I mean, we know for certain that's what he did. I don't want that one. Because otherwise, no? He would be no. further ahead.
Yeah,
are you
going to
get enough, though? To...
Maybe not. Oh, that was an N?
Yes.
Oh, God.
No, you don't have enough. This is all just practice now.
It's all practice now.
Oh, well.
I can still do it,
just
man.
Just see how far you can get.
Well, yeah, you could get, you could do it. Yeah, of course. You only have a few more to go.
No. I guess I do, but no.
It's you not. Have gotten 60 to 67 before.
Dude, okay.
This
so
what I'm saying
Nathan
is you can't really skip that many. You can skip three total.
I got to 67 with skipping.
James.
Now I'm doing it without skipping.
Nathan Strong
That's
gave
what
us
saying.
A reminder of the auction. Should we read off what
the obligatory
things are?
Auction
have we,
reminder.
Have we said that in a while? I don't know.
Mm-hmm. No. So it's, I'm... Yeah.
Are we playing another game or?
Yeah, we'll anyone? Maybe
well,
come
no,
back
you,
to this.
Yeah, but
somebody
I mean,
can play while I talk right. about it.
But yeah, I figure.
Yes,
thank
there
you,
is an
Nathan.
Auction. This is a fundraiser. It is for Stella. It's the Stella-thon. And we have a whole bunch of amazing auction items. We have 12 that were generously donated by a lot of the community.
That's right.
We have, let me just read out. All these itchy as soon
yes,
as you start doing
of course.
Things.
Itchy eye.
Ooh, don't think I have it down here. Let me do it off of here.
Cool.
That'll be easier. So I want to get who donated them. We'll do a really detailed one. Okay.
Yeah, and then we can see where they're at.
Yes. So, we've got Draconian, which is complete in box and signed by Daryl Spice Jr. and donated by Daryl Spice Jr. And Draconian is at $51 Canadian, which is still a deal over buying it at the Atari Age store, I believe, with shipping. Because it all is all free shipping.
And that's a cool game, man.
Oh my god,
that's a very cool
game.
Saw us playing it earlier. It's really, really good.
And that's a game that's not exactly in a genre that I love, and I love that game.
Yeah.
Which means that they're fighting an uphill battle with it.
That's right, and succeeded. Medieval Mayhem, which we're going to be playing next, which is also by Daryl Spice Jr. and donated by him. It's complete in the box, with a rare clear shell cart and signed by him. So it's a steal right now, and I will be bidding on it if it stays this low. $39 Canadian.
Whoa.
Like, this is in a rare, clear shell.
No.
You cannot get this anywhere but here. Space Rocks, complete in box, signed with a fridge magnet by Daryl Spice Jr. Let's see, it's all different order on here. And that is $51, still an incredible deal. Space Rocks poster signed, which you can't buy, is $20. This is a rolled poster, donated by Daryl Spice Jr. and signed by Daryl Spice Jr. It'll come in a nice tube. We've got Stay Frosty 2, complete in box, limited edition, signed by Daryl Spice Jr. An amazing platformer game. That is $73. Doing very, very well, of course. It's a really, really good game. And it's a limited edition cart number 51. You cannot buy this. Stella's Stocking, cart number 153 with manual signed. Also, you cannot buy this, except at the eBay auction, donated by Daryl Spice Jr. and signed by Daryl Spice Jr. It's getting his name said a lot. $34, really good deal. Cheaper than the Atari Age store, so you definitely want to be bidding on that. And it is a limited edition one with a number signed. Can't buy it. Except here. Galaga, complete in box, signed, John Champeau, not even out. You will be probably the first person to get Galaga on cartridge. And that is an out-of-control price. That has really gone crazy. $315.
Wow.
It's 42 bids. It is out of control.
That's incredible.
Wow.
And well worth it. You'll be probably the first person in the world to have it in your hands.
Hence
the price. Your copy will have cost you $300-something, and other
That's
people's
right.
will be less It will just be less prestigious because they will have paid less for it.
And you'll have the honor of having it bought, supporting Stella, yeah. and bought it off of this specific auction.
Yours will be the one that supported Stella.
Yes.
And one of the social theories is exchange theory, which is that we value something by how much we exchange with it. So if you exchange $300 That's worth true. Of money, you're going to value it that much more.
That is That's, true.
I didn't That's know. True. I didn't know those keywords, but that was essentially what I was saying. Yeah, yeah.
It's
true.
What is the theory called?
It's called exchange theory.
Exchange theory.
It comes. It also comes a lot with rises up with addiction, actually, because they talk about the idea. One of the ways that exchange theory becomes important is with addiction. When you tell someone stop doing something, yeah. chances are they're not going to do that versus, okay, in exchange for you stopping drinking, what can we replace that with? Mm. And that's a much more effective way and more productive way to work. Or if you ask someone, you know, you now have to wear a seatbelt, but what can you do in exchange for that? Because people don't want to do things for nothing.
I guess that is the theory behind those coins that they give for 5 years sober, 1 year sober, 1 month sober, etc., exactly. etc. Yeah. Because you've earned this. This or, is what you exchange. This is exactly. worth something.
Or the Darcy Pollen one snack a day method, which you is you have a coin that you spend once per day. You spend it to yourself, and you are exchanging that coin for your snack.
And you get it back the next day?
And you get it back at the beginning of the day. What's that?
End of the night or the beginning of the day?
You get it at the beginning of the day.
Okay.
You will soon learn, however, to save it until later in the day.
Can you stack them up?
No, because it's one coin. There's no
Oh, there's
bank.
No second coin.
There's no bank.
So you and lose yet, your coin at the end of the day?
You just keep
sound.
It. But there's no extra coin. There's
you don't
no
get
second
any,
coin.
Oh, so there's
but
only
you
one
get
coin.
It back. You get
yeah,
it
you
back.
Get it back, yeah.
yeah.
And okay. so the thing that I found was that I used to drink pop and eat chocolate bars, but when I started the one snack a day with the coin thing, I stopped eating them, even if it was the end of the night and there was no other snack that I would get.
Isn't
I still wouldn't
hilarious.
Eat a chocolate
Pause.
Bar.
Pause. Stephen is going to bed. Thank you, Stephen, for everything you do with Stella. I'm glad you were able to hang out with us this long.
Mm-hmm.
And we're very happy to put this on for Stella and yourself to continue the amazing work that you do. Coordinating all the programmers and all the people that contribute to Stella. And the auction will continue for over the weekend. So the prices will just keep earning more and more money for Stella, which is awesome. And also the donations will be open for all the weekend as well. So it's bedtime for him. It's 1 a.m. there. And he says, sorry, guys, I have to finish up. It's 1 a.m. here now. Thanks for everyone for the effort. And
no
you're
need
very,
to
very
apologize,
welcome.
Man. Thanks for kicking
yeah.
around this.
Yeah.
It's
we
a long time.
Your company, man. Thank
have a good sleep.
Yeah, have a good sleep. The next one is the Retron 77. What did I say? Gallagher? Yes,
oh,
donated by John Champeau.
Too.
And that will be signed as well. So Excuse that me. is really a great item. And the Retron 77 controller, 77 console, and we're going to read out all the games it has on it.
It's probably insane amounts.
It is. From Oscar Toledo G and Thomas Jentsch. Aardvark demo from Andrew Davey and Thomas Jentsch. Boulder Dash demo. Chris Walton and Thomas Jentsch. Star Castle Arcade. From Thomas Jentsch, it's Jammed. Ram Pong minigame, Robot City 1 2K minigame, Swoops, the Stacks Work in Progress, Three Dots, Thrust Plus Platinum. From Daryl Spice Jr., he donated for the Retron 77, binaries for Draconian, Medieval Mayhem, Space Rock, Stay Frosty, Stay Frosty 2. Chris Walton, who's CDW on the Atari Age forums, he donated the binaries for Cheddary, which is pronounced completely wrong. It's a Russian word for the number 4.
Really? Okay, cool.
How is it pronounced? I can't remember. I looked it up like yesterday. Hunchy 2 and Juno First, one of the best shooters on the Atari 2600, Juno First.
Dude, we gotta play that. That's cool.
It's really... I haven't played it for a long time, actually, so... Manuel Rockstar donated Colony 7, Crazy Balloon, Gunfight, Seawolf, nope. Starfire... Andrew Davey donated QB, Oscar Toledo G, Space Raid, John Champeau, Conquest of Mars, Galaga Demo, Ladybug, Mappy Scramble, Super Cobra Arcade. Carl G and Maggie Vogel donated Space Game. So along with that comes... where's my list? Oh, there it is. It also comes with the manuals for every game that has been released that was donated by Ali Russo from Atari Age. And it comes with a 2600 adapter D9, a USB cable, OTG cable for the 2600 adapter, and a Retrobit Genesis gamepad, all donated by Nathan Strum, who we talked to last on an audio call, who does all the amazing artwork, which we revealed the Aardvark, which is still up on the monitor, actually, mm-hmm. the Aardvark cartridge. Astronomer, complete in box, limited edition, number 40, last copy, donated by David Fleming of Packrad Video Games. Is he still in the chat? He comes in and out. Atari 2600 Homebrew Companion, Volume 1 and 2, signed by Ed Fries, Daryl Spice Jr., Brock Kiesge, and Brian Mathern, and is donated by Brian Mathern, who's a Rena Foot, who's Rena. In the Eye of the Storm. He's still there. Actually, he's just commented. Thank you, Arena Foot. Gold Rush, complete in box, signed, donated by Dan Kitchen, who we talked to today as well, of Tiki Vision. Both Gold Rush and Galaga will be released and shipped approximately 2009 in the fourth quarter, so October, November-ish kind of thing, sometime around there. And Halo 2600, complete in box, signed by Ed Fries, donated by Al Urusso. So there's tons. Cheatery. There we go.
What was that in reference to?
It's a Tetris.
Okay, cool.
Port for the Atari 2600, and it's got great music and a great title screen. And I think Stella has now been updated so it can emulate it. So before it couldn't emulate it because it's got really special audio, I think it is. Like really crazy. It needed a separate chip for the audio. But now it can emulate it properly.
It needs to be mentioned that this is the easy setting.
This isn't even the hard setting of Wall Jump Ninja. What is the hard setting possibly like?
I think you get to higher levels faster. It's just that
you get to these spikes and stuff quicker.
Yeah.
It's just
like skip the hard. Skip
the easy stuff and get straight to the hard stuff. Yes. Yeah. It's just a different.
So if you want practice, yeah. I guess. I don't know if it's the exact same levels, though.
We gotta try the hard at some point. Yeah. I just want to see what it's like, even just once.
Yeah.
Accent on the tier. Chitiri. That's it. Chitiri. With a tiny little... Yeah. You have Brock's last name misspelled.
Uh-oh.
Oh, sorry.
Kiesge?
Kiegley. Kiegge.
Can you spell it out? Did he spell it?
K-E-A-G-E.
I will...
Kighe.
Fix that right now.
Third letter is not an S.
So I just delete the S?
K-E-A-G-H-E-Y.
Oh, I have to find it again.
Oh no. Lava death.
Okay, spell it out again.
Oh, K-E.
Cool. You want to sit here? Sure. It's a little easier.
I don't know how well I'm going to do. It's
so here is
smack in my head.
I don't think my skills are going to really...
K-E-A.
They improve. That's a miracle.
Okay.
Isn't it going on? Yeah. So
you're getting
it is corrected now.
I hit a wall.
Then I'm gonna.
I always hit a wall.
I'm gonna play.
Like,
okay, cool. Let me do one and then I'll pass it
or
over.
Something like that, and then it's. I always hit that wall. I can't get to this.
I think 60. I believe that you can.
I think
that,
I can
that method
too.
For sure.
It's just about doing it and just doing it over and over till I get it. This guy's like 150 world records.
Jesus.
He's
okay.
A really good player.
And he's probably going to like push it.
I need to memorize where
that's
the letters.
That's just
because
that's,
I
guarantee you, someone like that's motivation is to get records.
And I missed
only one.
And why would you keep playing if you have the record?
One, and then
you wouldn't.
You'd stop. 57.
Unless you really, like, this isn't the type of game where you,
like,
you do play for enjoyment, but once you get to that certain level, it's like, oh, God.
Oh, yeah. This
is brutal. Are you done?
Yeah. Well, I already died, so. And I want more time for you to be able to do it.
Okay.
It's going to be more.
It's more exciting when someone competent is playing.
Well, yeah, but also I know that we have a limited amount of time, and I don't want to, you know, the odds of me doing.
Sorry, I didn't mean to imply you were confident.
No,
I meant like James.
I'd be the first to say it.
I meant it in reference to myself more so to you. But I meant like he's doing really well.
No,
so,
hell yeah.
Sorry.
No, it's all good.
A really good game to track
down.
It's
so much fun, though.
I'm in awe of this game. Because at first, you kind of, it's easy to go, oh, it's just a stick guy jumping.
No.
But, oh, it's so much more than that.
Controls are so tight.
Yeah.
It goes to
then,
show if you
and then
nail
you bring
the
in
movement.
The plumb bobs, and it all just goes to hell really
yep.
quickly.
I use this program for syncing up my audio and video.
Yeah?
The timing for the capture cards. Because I do the pressing of the button, and it's so perfectly precise to when he jumps. There's no delay. It's such a tight game that that's what I use this game for. and it makes a sound, too. So it's a really good combination. I use other programs, too, but...
No, it comes back to that thing we were talking about. What, with John Champeau, right?
Yes.
Where it's like, this could not be more lo-fi, pretty much.
It is lo-fi.
It's a stick figure jumping on a thing. But, man, when you get the movement right, that's what matters.
Yeah, it's really satisfying movement.
Oh, James maybe had a message, but that's okay.
You might have.
Yeah.
What? Message for tomorrow?
No, Adri.
Did you?
Oh, no, I haven't done anything.
Okay.
I told her that you can't make it.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Because that's what you said, right?
That is correct.
Okay.
Thank you. Uh-oh, I've got the J. I'm in trouble.
You have to dodge, which is too bad, but that's all right.
Very careful.
Better
it's
than
better
not
than,
having it.
Yeah, it's better than not having
it. Yeah, when you didn't have it, I was like, I guarantee
you're
going to get it, and it'll be the worst.
Yeah.
It's all moot. Excuse me, it's a moo point.
Totes moo.
Moo. What did Spicewort say about the music for Chitiri?
Chitiri's music is similar to DPC, so square waves only, but uses a fast fetcher like DPC+.
Okay. I don't know what that means.
Nope, I don't either. And then Nathan Strump said Daryl made a sync checker for the 2600.
Whoa! I think I use that. It's called Pop Check? Or something, because it has a countdown and then a pop and a sound and a flash on the screen. That's actually what I've been using since he passed that over to me.
You have a first right
instead
I
of
do.
This. But this was really useful before. I think it's called Pop Check. Super good.
What do you think of Stranger Things so far, Tanya?
Oh, we watched it.
last episode,
really,
like almost 3 days.
Really good. I really liked it. I thought this season was really good.
You're done. You guys are finished?
Oh, yeah.
That's great.
Have you seen it?
Oh, yeah. It's awesome.
All of it?
Darcy hasn't seen the last episode.
No?
So we can't discuss specifics.
I don't know if I said it on stream. I don't remember what we said at this point. But the last episode was like had some stuff that was a little too cheesy for me.
Yes.
But
yeah.
Yes. I kind of let it go. Like I was, and the musical number was a bit much for me too.
Oh no! The singing, I was like, oh, why? Why would you throw that in there? It was so cheesy.
There's
a
meme about slowing down well-known pop music for movies now, especially in trailers, like a slow version of a well-known song.
Yeah.
Oh.
And it just was like, but man, I like the redemptive arc of some of the characters. I like
Damn
what
it.
They chose to deal with it. How do you think it compares to season 2 for you?
So soon it will be time to ka-chunk chunk into
the screen?
Fourth quarter.
Okay.
Yes, we're so close.
Oh,
yeah.
Terrible.
Sorry, say that again.
Oh, how does it compare for you to the first and second season?
It's funny because I have a limited memory of the second season.
Because it was bad and you blocked it out.
Well, there's some good
James
stuff in
didn't
it.
James didn't like it. I don't remember not liking it. I remember James complaining about it and me ignoring
the bee story. The terrible, terrible bee story of those.
Yeah, it wasn't
people
as
with
good.
Powers.
We enjoyed it.
I like the bee story.
We did, like, Tamara
well,
and I, we did think...
Well, I didn't understand the bee story at all, why it was even in there,
yeah,
because
like,
they did nothing with those
filler?
I think it's that people didn't like the bee story. And that's why they haven't done anything with those people yet.
Oh,
no,
because
but
I think that's what
they didn't
were
do anything with them in season 2
but
either,
I think that was for
so
this
I found
season.
That really
I thought I think that was set up for the future and that people just didn't like it, so they didn't go there.
I remember so little of season 2. I just what's his face? I love that actor who died in it.
Season two.
What's that actor's name? Rudy.
80s actor.
The 80s actor
was in
Rudy.
Lord of the Rings.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Sean Astin.
Yeah. So I like Sean Astin a lot.
He's a hilarious actor.
I really like him. And so that's all I remember from season two is him. And, yeah, the Terrible Beast Story. But I don't know. But I really like season three. Story,
no, he wasn't. I liked him. No. In season two, and Billy was very cool. Yeah. And, like, the relationship.
Damn it.
Sorry.
That's not how you do it.
Not at all.
Are you drunk?
Yeah.
Very drunk off
with power.
we'll
switch games after this.
Yeah.
Because nobody wants to see me play 5 hours of
Dude, I'm fucking in. Yeah. I got my beer. I'm in.
Because I will play this till I get the record. And yeah. That is not fun for
anyone.
I
believe in you, James.
Yeah. No, I always like with Stranger Things how the way they work, I don't know if it's the story or the plot, but how they discover it is everyone discovers things independently and then comes together.
Yeah.
And that seems to be the theme for every season, is you have all these groups working independently and they have no idea what other people are doing.
This
and then it
a,
all
But this
it all
was
comes
the strongest
together.
Writing in terms of that. Was
yeah,
this
I
season.
Thought it was really
the,
good.
Like,
yeah.
The like sitcom formula is you have like five characters
yeah.
and then you have them all together in the beginning and
yeah.
then they break off into A plot, B plot, and then they come together at the end.
Yeah.
That's
but,
the Seinfeld
yes.
formula.
But
and that's just, it was like specific to Seinfeld was a thing that they did where it was
well,
like
yeah.
okay in the end they're all going to come together with their thing and we I say this because we were just listening to like the audiobook about Seinfeld
mm-hmm.
and they were noting that that was one of the things that they did that was like
very smart and
yeah,
they're supporting
yeah.
and that's and Stranger Things is basically that but like on a macro level much
on a
larger
bigger level.
Yeah.
Yes. And then you have A, B, C and then they all do collide
they collide at the end
and
yeah.
it's like and episode one is just like you know, mostly teaser. And then episode one
yeah.
ends with, like, some supernatural
Uh-oh.
Element that
yeah.
opens it up to be,
I
like... Up.
I don't think
I don't know.
No, because the next one is unavoidable. And that's why I didn't
okay,
get that
yeah.
one.
But,
yeah.
like, most... I'd say that's, like, just, like, the sitcom, because, like, that 70s show, Friends, Community, like, all those shows have that, like... That very
structure.
Similar thing. It's like there
yeah, but Friends came after Seinfeld.
It's
and
true.
And apparently copied it in a way that is not obvious.
Yeah.
Saying copied, like, was influenced by it.
Well, for
in
sure.
In a
But, like,
way.
Sanford and Sons was doing shit like that before then, and Larry Sanders' show, so...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, there it's like that, but that's a form
yeah.
of TV that
yeah.
was just its
yeah.
own...
I
So hard.
Yeah, I hear ya. It's pretty cool.
Okay.
You like it when there's, like, some organization to it. It's not just a bunch of chaos.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
But
if you
yeah.
could load up Warlords,
so
or not Warlords,
and I really
Medieval
like,
Mayhem. Actually, don't do that. I have to plug in the paddles.
Okay, cool. But it is, but the thing that makes that show good is I love all the characters. So like, I'm so down to see. I feel like there is almost no A B C plot because A
yeah.
implies that A is more important than B. But like
yeah.
with Stranger Things, I'm like, oh, they all felt like A plots to me.
Yeah,
they're all very balanced.
I was like invested in all their like and all the character moments too. I was like,
yeah.
damn, this is good TV. Dan ABC's out too.
Oh,
bye, Dan.
Did anyone just hear that?
Yeah.
Music.
Music
that was beautiful.
Outside. Yeah. I only have one
Later
set of
down.
Paddles, so...
Oh, no.
Oh, is it going to be easy to get more? Yes.
James, you're 10 out of 10 organized.
Yes. The box is accessible. There are beer cans of various states of empty and not empty.
Oh, just it's completely empty. And there's just one.
What was that?
I'm gonna fish the fruit fly out of my wine right
now. Yeah, that sounds like a...
Damn, that's fruit fly.
Oh, perfect.
There we go.
Thanks, man.
Another set of paddles.
Cool.
Hopefully they all work.
Ah, and if they don't, that's half the fun.
So we're gonna play Medieval Mayhem.
I've never played Medieval Mayhem, I think.
It's easy to learn, hard to master.
Should I load it up or should I wait till you plug in the paddles?
No.
Okay,
we're gonna plug
Excuse
the
me.
Paddles in first. If you can pass me the second paddle.
Sure, one second.
You have four. You did find four.
Yeah,
I
just
go.
Didn't have four out because it's so rare that we have four players at once. Okay.
Is this it? Is this what?
Is this what?
That's the real question.
This is it. This is the real thing.
Should we have?
Oh, God, what is it doing?
It's sort of... I think it's the other ones, because this is number two. Okay. Those are probably... Yeah. These are probably number one.
Because if they're not in the middle, they start flipping.
Oh, God.
It's just scrolling. It's scrolling.
Okay, I'm going to plug them in after.
Yeah, okay, cool.
You can hold those.
Got it.
It was violent.
It's... Do you want me to hold down the button? Or
okay. No. That's only for that specific joystick.
Oh, okay, cool. Very cool.
Oh, this is painful.
We shall get there. Wow. No, 3 hours to go.
Woo!
No, oh, yeah. Man. We're so starting bad. A regular show right now.
That's right.
Just a reminder. True.
This is a normal showtime.
I've noticed in life, the last quarter of everything is always the weirdest to the hardest. And I don't think it'll be the hardest. I think it's just going to be the weirdest. That's my prediction.
Oh, gee, why is it so long?
Oh, yeah. No. Man, Halo was a cool game. That's yes. Cool that's part of the package.
It is.
I was pretty blown away by that. It was a good conversion. That's one that feels like my childhood. I started playing that game when I was very young. Mm-hmm. I was actually maybe 11 when I played Halo 1 for the first time. And that's quite a formative time to play a game.
Okay.
11, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
James, can I get you some more water?
Yes, please. Okay, so let's flip those over to that side.
Pass this. Mm-hmm. Thanks. Oh, you've got a cat. Watch. You're going to sit on a cat there.
Squish.
That's all right. Squish. Hey,
no,
buddy.
He's fine.
Oh, no.
There's room. Okay, can
you... Oh, I've never played this one before. That's very cool.
Okay, so I don't think I have a Medieval Mayhem icon, so I'm just going to blank it out.
Okay, cool. Yeah, man. No one expects you to prepare 12 hours worth of icons.
Random games that I haven't played on the show before.
What games are left? McMuse asks. This is the 1 and 2.
Because
I figured that it would make sense to.
Okay, so it is working. Good. Okay.
I figured we give those.
What
to
games
them.
Are left? I want to play Crazy Balloon. Because there's that guy beat my world record on Crazy Balloon, but yeah. He beat it like a lot, so I may not do well on that.
But you
I want to give it a try.
Be just, fun no matter what.
Yeah.
Man, those aardvark things were beautiful.
Might as well keep that up in the
super,
background.
Super into the aardvark.
Let's see what other games I have scheduled. We could play any game.
Yeah, we're kind of at the...
At that
free-for-all. You kicked around for this long. Just tell us what games
tell us what
play.
You want
we'll
us to
it.
Play. Oh, yes, Astronomer.
Yes, we
so
got to try to
we're playing Astronomer
that.
After this,
cool.
I think. Because I want to... I think that's achievable to get a patch. It's like an easy to...
I think it's just because they're on the ground. They're saying paddle flicker,
yeah,
which is
I know.
For sure the case. But
they're on the ground.
It's just
there
how it's
go.
Going. Okay, so it's almost 9 o'clock. I might just do it now. This is a nice time.
Do we only
to
have two?
Start,
yep. So we're going to take a 2-second break so I can, like literally 2 seconds, so I can stop and start
one
the local recording.
No flipping.
Two 1,000.